So,
right. Hello and welcome to Commentaries episode 30, which means it's a drinking game commentary.
Hey, we're going to get blasted.
We are. And today we're going to get blasted while watching The World's End. It seemed fitting to do a drinking game to this film. It's quite easy to come up with rules for it. And in terms of this trilogy, we've pretty much said all we, you know,
I mean,
need to say in other places.
The last two commentaries you listened to would have been Shaun of the Dead and Hot Fuzz, so I think you could have basically seen this one coming.
And to be fair, a lot of the, like, any trivia or background information, it's all pretty well publicised for all three of these, so you can find it. So we figured it'd be more fun to do a drinking game
for this one. Yeah, we're not going to harp on about stuff that everyone already knows like we did last time, but we got some good stuff in there, but
yeah
we thought we'd try something different. I mean, originally the rules were you pick a character and you drink what they drink.
Yeah.
However, after that was the plan for a long time, we realised that being Gary King may not have been a good idea, trying to consume 11 pints in, what, an hour and 40 minutes?
He doesn't take down the last pint.
Yeah, so there's 11 because there's 11 pubs. 12 pubs, right?
Oh, yeah. No, so you're right, sorry.
But then again, like Neil pointed out, he's probably already had one or two before he's gotten there. So, so I would have probably had to start pre-drinking. And then we realized, trying to drink 12 pints in just under 2 hours,
and pretty much all of those within an hour and a half because the drinking doesn't kick in for the initial bit of the film.
So we've whittled down the rules. We just thought, forget that, we'll try and do something a bit simpler. So, Neil, will you tell us the rules and tell everyone the rules for this drinking game?
Okay,
so
the rules for our version.
Like, get munted to it.
Our version of The World's End is it's really fucking deadly simple, right? Okay. The main rule is when you see someone drink on screen, you drink. Now, it doesn't necessarily mean you have to drink the same quantities they're drinking, but if there's a shot of someone drinking, you drink.
Like there.
Man, that makes no sense to anyone.
We're watching the menu screen.
So
there's a lot of drinking.
That made no sense. Also, for anyone who's keeping up with the menu screens, this one's green. So the Blu-rays have got red menu screen for Shaun of the Dead, blue for Hot Fuzz, and green for The World's End. It's a nice little addition. Main rule, see someone drinking, you drink. Every time you see someone drinking, you drink. Secondary rule that we've got mainly for the first 10, 15 minutes of the film, really, is just so you have drinks early on, is that every time there's a piece of foreshadowing, you drink. So that's just to get you through the initial stage. There is some bits of foreshadowing, sort of once they start drinking, but I'm happy to ignore it from that point on because it's just to get you a little bit buzzed before the
pub
call starts.
It's like the basketball commentary last time we did. It was the first half hour there's some drinks in there, but it's pretty light, and then all of a sudden it gets chaotic.
I don't know, the basketball commentary is pretty heady from the
get-go. But then it gets towards
if you're doing
the
drink just every time someone says dude, bitch, or sweet, you'd never stop drinking from beginning to end.
It ups it again after the first
drinking
half hour.
Every time Squeak takes offence to something. I mean, it's just ridiculous.
We weren't kind to ourselves.
No, that was quite vicious. Third rule is every time someone or something loses a body part of some description.
Yeah, I forgot that one.
You take a drink, so one of the robots, I'll call them, or blanks loses an arm or a leg or half of their head for one particular character, then you take a drink there as well. An additional thing that I'm doing that Guy isn't doing is in the pub when they take down an entire pint in one go, I'm going to finish off whatever drink I've got. I'm going to take it down as well.
I'll do like an extra couple of fingers or something.
We'll see. I might only have a little bit at the bottom of my can, so I might look out. But if I've got a full can in my hand at that stage, I'm going to take down a whole can. That's going to be interesting.
Well, Neil is pretty hardcore with these things. I've seen the man down half a bottle of wine.
I want it to be good. If I'm going to suffer for my art, I at least want to, make it good art. So, and our final rule, which is the rule that carries over for everything, but I don't think it applies to this. If Guy says it at some point in this film, he's just saying
just because there's been a pause and no one's drunk for 2
minutes. He's just saying it for the sake of it, but there honestly isn't a too gay for comfort moment. The idea being, if it's too gay for comfort, you drink. That's a joke, by the way, not that if it's genuine. If it's genuinely too gay for comfort, you might want to open your horizons a little bit. So Yeah,
that's that bit where they're walking down the street. Ooh.
So that is the setup. Yeah, we will let the.
So we've all heard Neil's Neil's going into it. Neil's just like hot and heavy. He's gonna get it. I mean, as we all know, like I'm a steady drinker. I like to pace myself. Yep. I like to spend the evening getting wasted.
Says the guy who's already had about three mouthfuls of beer. Right. Oh yeah, and the drinks we're drinking, we've actually manned up a bit. Usually there's a girly element to our drinking. This time we're ciders and we're beers. Mm-hmm. So
I'm drinking the very lovely Kingfisher because
I'm drinking Magners. As always, I'm drinking cider because it's all I ever drink. So a consistent thing from me. So okay, I'll open my can. Mm.
Kingfisher, I love Indian beer. Good, really refreshing.
That beautiful sound.
That is Neil, gee whiz. Keep it in your pants for that.
Audible porn.
Audible
beer porn. let's get this ball rolling. Okay, right. Okay, and then I'll.
Now comes the awkward pause where we have to stop the film and do your little counting.
Good bit that I edit out.
New rule: you drink on the opening, first drink, just to salute the film. Whatever. That's just an excuse.
Press play in 3, 2, 1. Now.
Good. We're going. Okay. Here we are. We're starting up.
Right. Let's go. Let's kick this off. Right. As we do with all our commentaries, our lovely commentaries, we're gonna run you in with some numbers for the film. It's tradition, whatever. Budget for this film, that depends on where you look. Quickly, before we started, I looked up budget, according to this film, on Wikipedia, is $20 million. Although, if you flip over to IMDb, it's an estimated $28 million. That sounds a bit more realistic, because, you know, this is Edgar Wright, you know, established Edgar Wright. So, there we go. According to drink.
Yep, there's one.
According to Wikipedia, the box office so far taking is $46 million. Sounds about right. The opening weekend gross for... Let's just do some release dates first. That makes more sense. Original release date, the London premiere, was the 10th of July, 2013. That was in the UK. It released 9 days later.
He's all math. Reference drink. All right.
So 19th of July 2013, it was released across the UK. 18th of July, it was New Zealand. Iceland got it 31st of July, Australia the 1st of August. Pick out some key date things. Canada, USA got it 23rd of August 2013. Germany, 12th of September 2013, going down the list. Mexico, 11th of October. Norway, 18th of October. There we go. Box office takings opening weekend in America, it released this is 1,500 odd screens, 1,551 screens, so 25th of August 2013. Opening weekend in dollars, it grossed $8,790,237. Did quite well in America. Haven't got any UK things, but there we go. So a very profitable film, and the DVDs and stuff have been selling like no one's business. So yeah, it's another profitable, awesome, wonderful film.
It is.
But there we go.
Technically, all of these are references, but
right, okay.
I'm going to have a couple of good gulps for all these pubs. Because each pub's title has something to do with what takes place in it. Lovely. That's shots. Why it's foreshadowing. This is a bit of foreshadowing, so here we go with heavy going foreshadowing. There's another bit, so that's two.
Christ.
And they're drinking on screen twice.
Fuck.
And again. And again.
Fuck me.
Okay. That's your first rather bright. Oh, the Reverend Green. Have a drink.
I don't like your rules, Neil.
Yeah, it did as well, so we drink.
Drink.
Which he does, so you drink.
What? Alright, okay.
Right. He has to let her go, so you have to have a drink. And then they drink, so you drink. Ripping the shirt, you take another drink.
Fuck, you dick.
The Bowls Club is another one.
Christ.
Pete Chuck to Whitey. That's a reference to what happens to Pete at the end.
I love that little bit with the flashing.
Heading for the hills. And for those of you paying close attention, you're going to see like a shooting star in the corner of the at the top of the frame here. There
it's
it is.
Aliens.
That's the aliens network. Coming. So that is one more drink.
Right. Well, I'm...
And I'm nearly done. you see the Mary, the zombie, sat next to Simon Pegg in this scene as well, from Shaun of the Dead. And the track of the other side of him looks like he was from Shaun of the Dead as well, but he isn't. Yeah.
Yeah, got a point out. Sorry.
Yep.
The casting in that opening sequence is absolutely superb.
They spent a lot of time trying to get the right people. And there's footage on the Blu-ray of them sort of walking around, following the actors around, make sure they had the walk and the mannerisms down of the actors right. So you really do get a feel for the same person.
I love this bit here. I love this little title thing. The way it fades out and then you get the beer glass logo. Oh, it's just... this. I don't know why. I think it's maybe one of my favourite things in the entire film.
It is. It's a very good opening. What very simple, but very effective. And a very good choice of song as well.
What a beautiful transition that is. But no, like, you look back...
And this shot. I like this. The setting up each character in this sort of one...
Great. So smooth.
One kind of shot
so
as well.
So smooth. Who we got on there? Primal Scream. Of course. Loaded.
Yep.
Yeah, like the young lady playing Rosamund Pike's younger self. I mean, gee whiz, like a spitting image.
Just gee whiz, you don't usually hear that in twice in one paragraph.
This got pointed out.
Right, look, read the newspaper. That's a bit of foreshadowing right there. Happier Britain. I'm nearly down a can.
Yeah, I'm drinking like the big Kingfishers.
You haven't, you're taking smaller gulps as well at this stage. I probably will out my gulps a little bit.
This is my second glass.
Is it?
Yeah, I had to top it up.
Oh, that was quick.
I'm a good time. No, the gee whiz thing, like, I was at work the other day, because I use the phrase gee whiz all the time, apparently.
You do use it quite a lot.
And someone's like, gee whiz? Who says that anymore? I was like, I say gee whiz, what's wrong with that?
It's just outdated with your exclamations. Nothing wrong with that, though.
Gee whiz. Well, I'm setting a trend. I'm doing it my own.
Setting a trend that was set a long time ago and long since went out of date. It's like when you tried to bring Cowabunga back.
I'm liking that episode of... It's like the episode of... I was on a loser from that from the beginning. I love this guy. He's just like... He just has so much hatred for fucking Gary
King. The look in his eyes here is pretty fantastic.
He almost looks like he's going to be... Looks a bit like a zombie as well. No, what was I going to say? Oh, yeah, the whole cowabunga thing. Like, it's like the episode of South Park where the guys do that. They start that trend. It's one of the photo trends, you know. And they keep it doing...
Their battle commence, drink.
And everyone's like, that was, you know, everyone's not doing that. Everyone's not, you know, moved on to a different trend, but they keep doing it. And then don't they get praised for doing it? It's like, it's going to happen. I keep up the trends. I keep going, what the...
Yeah.
Oh. Please cut that. I didn't even give it wholehearted what's up as well. What's up?
That's badass. More oomph in.
But it's not like a because they're like, what up? Mine's a what's up.
A what's up, old chap?
What's up? This is a British exclamation, you know, don't you know?
So can you remember your very, very early initial reaction to this film?
Enjoyed it. Wasn't my favourite. It's one of those things, you just need to keep watching it to get more and more from it.
It does grow on you each time. The first time I watched it, I did really like it.
Yeah. I really liked it.
I was apprehensive a little bit. It was... Something about it didn't quite sit right. I don't know exactly what it was. I knew I liked it, but I knew there was something a bit off with it. Or at least that was my initial feeling. But with each viewing, I've liked this more. Sort of, it's got the Hot Fuzz thing about it, but... ultimately, this has resulted in me actually liking this more than Shaun of the Dead. So,
It's got a different style to it.
It's a completely different film to the other two.
I love Simon Pegg in this. It just makes me laugh.
Yeah.
It is
the biggest performance he's had to give as an actor, which is partly the reason why they wrote the character the way they did. Because Simon was just getting a bit sick of sort of playing a particular type. So he wrote himself. Essentially, he's the villain of the entire film, if you're to really study it. So He found that a bit more interesting in a character that's so despicable and trying to make that character likable at the same time. But very, very good performance from Simon Pegg in this.
Yeah. I agree. And after watching, we were watching, I'm not sure, did we mention it on one of the other commentaries, the Danger 50,000 Volts with Nick Frost? We went back, Neil fished out the DVD, and there's apparently, it was only released on the DVD, there's a special, it's called Danger 50,000 Zombies. And it's basically quite soon after Shaun of the Dead, post Shaun of the Dead, isn't it?
It was pre-Shaun of the Dead, I think. I think it would have been a promotional thing. But
yeah, he plays... Simon Pegg plays an Australian, basically, zombie killer, professional zombie killer, and he's teaching Nick Frost what to do. Go back. We found it on YouTube. It's on the Facebook...
Expositionist page, yeah.
Yeah, on the Expositionist page. It is on there, so go back and watch it. It's very funny. It's just those guys, and if you're watching, playing zombies, there's some good moments in there, and it's just... When you let Simon Pegg off the hook and do his stuff...
Yeah.
I actually like him a lot more.
he's an actor.
Like, things like that, the whole fuck off thing.
He's better if you don't direct him too much, probably, you think.
If you just let him improvise and stuff, and you can kind of see where... How he got where he is, because... He's very good. He's very good at his impressions, his voices, and he's actually very funny when he's being himself and doing his little skits.
Yeah.
So I think that's probably why it doesn't, when you have to contain him and, you know, when you let him just do his thing, it's excellent. And you get more of that in this. You get him being let free a bit more, and that's why he comes across so much more entertaining and just so much, he's just great in this.
But same can't be said for Martin Freeman.
Martin Freeman's all
who needs a lot of directing in order to get decent.
Yeah, he's all right. I mean, he's starting to grow on me. I think
The Hobbit's helped a little bit with that, even though you're not a fan of him. But
I mean, let's face it, there was like no one else they were going to cast. He was always going to be top choice for that job.
And speaking of good performances, I mean, Nick Frost in this is so great because it. I mean, the big gimmick of this really is that their friendship dynamic has been flipped in this, Nick Frost is playing the straight guy, and Simon Pegg's playing the fuck up. So this is quite a subdued Nick Frost performance, which gradually gets more absurd as the film goes on, the drunker he gets. But he is still funny, even as like the really subdued, serious character. Like in this scene...
60 pints.
The scene about you must be thirsty then, that joke, his reaction to that. Oh, fantastic stuff. Hilarious.
That's good. Memory, Gary. Oh, thanks. It's just that they really play up a lot of the gags in this, but it works fine. You know, it's like a lot of the other gags in the other two films are quite subtle.
Yeah.
I mean, and you get the subtleties in this, but you get...
This has got a much bigger story than the other two. It's much broader.
I think personally, the thing I've never really...
He called Newton Haven a black hole, by the way. That's foreshadowing what's going to happen at Newton Haven. I have missed a couple of the foreshadowing references, I think.
Oh, I've been drinking anyway. Slow and steady wins the race. And gets you munted. I love that. It's such a simple gag. And it's like
rare that you get a setup and a payoff to in a film within like 2 minutes of each other as well. Yeah. That's such a quick setup and payoff.
And it's almost like I'm not going to quote Rush, but it's like going down the Chris Tucker mentality. He's really annoying, but you get to go with all the straight characters, like, and you know we've all got friends that we really like, but sometimes they're just. Like they're just a bit too much, you know.
Roger Rabbit's like that as well.
Yes, exactly. It's that character, you know, the life of the party. They're annoying as fuck, but they, you know, there's so much life in them.
Yeah,
you're drawn to them. It's a standard character, but it's great in this.
I think it helps that everyone has that bit in them where they like, oh, I just wish I could be like I was when I was at the prime.
Yeah.
And that I think everyone can relate to
time.
That.
So. I mean, everyone wants to go back in time, rectify the mistakes. I would go, I just heard the, this is great listening to this with the headphones and you get all the details and the boom, boom, boom from the train station, that's cool. No, I'll get there eventually that's there again. No, that's going to haunt my dreams. Boom, boom, boom. National Rail wants some more money from me. Leave me alone. No, Did I hear that one, or was that?
Yeah, that's no. That's a bit foreshadowing there.
And one beer down.
Oh.
Open number two. So this one. So wait, said, wait, wait, how does this one sound?
Oh, that's a bit gay for comfort.
Oh, fuck off, you tosser.
I will get my thought out. No, it's out of all of the things like.
I realise I'm sat in exactly the same way fucking Nick Frost is. I'm just onto my position.
No, out of like, you know, you've got zombies, the cop thing, you know, you're all thing, and now you've got sort of Invasion of the Body Snatchers, basically, you know, that whole thing, that whole sci-fi thing.
Driving that... electrically further, the fact that all of Newton Haven is driving the same car as on the post in the background, that's a little bit of foreshadowing as well. So I'll drink to that.
You're not wrong. Problem. Great. This is the best thing about the introduction. You get some before you can get into the drama. You get all the gags, and they just like let's just knock it. Like the Alexander Dumas joke. I mean, that just like literally, it's just like write that. Oh my god, that has to happen.
Yeah,
that is the best joke. You know, but I will get out. Like I think the whole science fiction element to it. That's probably where I. May have had difficulties. I love... honestly, I could watch this film any... Oh, I fucking love this. That joke is so...
following up with Antiques Roadshow, well, which also is a joke about the sound effect they had there as well.
Yeah, and the Antiques Roadshow is like...
Yeah.
But it's like the Antiques Roadshow... that's not really a gag that would translate to America. Basically...
Well, they do have Antiques Roadshow in America.
Really?
They had an American version of it, yeah.
Does this count as antiques? It's like,
well,
stuff from like, because like,
well, they have an antiques roadshow, so they antiques are sold all over the world. Yeah. So no, don't have to be American.
I was going to make a snobby joke that our country is very very old and America isn't.
Our antiques are older than everyone else's.
Yeah,
yeah.
Basically, what a twat I am. look at Paddy
Considine in the background. There's that. It's great.
Yeah, my favorite thing on the commentary of this when I watched it way back when was Simon Pegg keeps calling Eddie Marzan and Eddie Marsden, and he's just like, and they make there's some great gags they do in like you know about party cons. It's just good. No, it's the sci-fi element isn't really my thing. That's cool. That isn't really sort of my area. So I think maybe
our focus. All... We haven't got any drinks in this bit. You're okay.
Get you're drinking finished. Coffee. You got a drink.
What?
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 Oh, well, fine. Fuck it. Slow and steady loses the race. makes me...
Sci-fi isn't really your thing. So that was what...
Sci-fi is my thing. It's that whole old school science fiction, like 50s and, you know, 50s, 60s science fiction, which, you know, I'll be honest with you. It's not that I dislike it. It's, you know, whatever. greatness. I'd fade. It's almost the Gavin and Stacey joke when the fucking Dave coaches.
Yeah.
Gavin and Stacey, for anyone who America doesn't know, probably won't.
I think has travelled over to America.
Didn't they do it?
They've done an American version of it.
Yeah. It was a very popular show here. But if you sort of go back to it, like that's a Baby Cow production thing, so they may not know this. Baby Cow is a production company founded by Steve Coogan, who was in Hot Fuzz at the beginning, so there you go.
There we are.
There you go, I'll drop that in. Some people may not know that.
Sure, I didn't know that Steve Coogan was part of Baby Cow, actually.
It's Steve Coogan, he found it. That's why Steve Coogan is like the executive producer.
But we paint the town red, a bit of foreshadowing.
It's, shit. There's a great line in that Danger 50,000 Volts zombie special I'll spoil it if I say it, actually, but I kind of want to say it.
Yeah.
Fuck it.
Especially it's fuck it is it. The bit that makes Guy laugh hysterically, but it is very funny.
But either way, like, I mean, I'm sure there's different drinking game versions to this.
I've seen numerous different drinking games.
So, like,
for
you know,
already.
Fuck it, you don't have to follow ours, but, you know, if you want to go do another one, we'll be hurt, but, you know, you're in the spirit.
Well, didn't you have a friend who tried doing just the dude rule in
Jake.
Basketball? You said someone in Oxford or something tried it.
Yeah, it's.
How did he do?
It's a hard game. There, Jake, if you're here, I love you to bits. You're here. Well, you're not here. but you're listening, Jake, I'm in your head.
I don't know you, but thank you for trying our podcast.
You'd love Jake. Jake is a fucking... Oh, love Jake a bit.
No, as I said, my initial reaction was a bit mixed. The science fiction thing in this, I didn't have a problem with it, actually.
I don't have a problem with it, it's just I can't, I think that's...
I think what... when I first watched it, my biggest thing I wished wasn't the case with it was I didn't think it was that funny.
Yes.
And that the story was a bit more serious, and it is a more serious film. It's definitely... the case, but a lot of the humour you find after the fact, I found with this, it comes from repeat viewings.
Yeah.
But I think the science fiction element to it was actually the bit I enjoyed the most upon first watching. I actually became a bit more invested and interested based on what was happening. And it was just jarring, I think, especially when I saw it after watching the first two, and it doesn't transition that smoothly. Mm. Watching them back to back doesn't really do this film that much.
Yeah, it's one of those films that does certainly grow on you. It's not quite as... You got to put a few more watches into this to get everything from it. Like you do with Shaun of the Dead and Hot Fuzz, but on the surface of things, you can kind of... Fuck it, this film's awesome.
It is amazing.
I love it to bits.
That's Julia Deakin. She's in Spaced, Hot Fuzz, Shaun of the Dead. She's in the entire trilogy. Everyone who's in both Shaun of the Dead and Hot Fuzz is in this. Just as an additional thing.
Be a plot.
Martin Freeman is another example of that. He's in all three.
Yeah. I like the fact that Andy's in the background. That's good. No, I was going to say, the guy on the motorcycle, I think that's the guy from Sightseers, which I'm going to have to watch. I haven't got around to it yet, but I will get there. Who's this? Suede? Yeah, this is Suede. What's the track name?
Yeah, I can't remember the names of the songs in this. Lots of good songs in the soundtrack. But in terms of soundtracks, I think this is... In terms of soundtrack albums...
This is the weakest.
The weakest one in terms of, like, it's not mixed in the same way that the others are. And it's just songs, straightforward soundtrack dialogue, list. Yeah.
There's a great one. And this is... The thing about working at HMV, and I just signed a thing last week that says you can't talk about HMV on social media and shit, so fuck it. If you're listening, anyone there, and sack me, you gotta beef with it, just bring it up, whatever. No, but there's this is just a funny anecdote, if you will. You can only play
teenagers. I'll have a drink for them, they're pretty relevant later on.
You can only I work at HMV, drink. But like you can only play when you're on, you can only play on the screens. You can only, on the DVD file, you can only play certain certificate films in case children are in.
Mm.
Likewise, you can't play any soundtracks that have swearing in them. But sometimes, shit happens. Like, I remember I accidentally put the Big Lebowski on thinking, that's not much swearing in this. Then I remember there's that song that has all the sex noises in it. I was like, oh, it's a bit awkward. But there's a really good one. We had the World's End soundtrack on, which is excellent. I was like, fucking great.
Yeah.
But there's a soundbite on it where Nick Frost, rips it, which is, I fucking hate this town, which was just full blast across the DVD floor. And it was on for a few hours. I took it off, but which I'm not going to, I shouldn't admit to that. I'm shameful I took that off. But it made me laugh. Everyone looked up, oh God. That was quite funny.
This is...
I don't like that. I don't want to talk
about that. A bit of observation about the way pubs have gone, which is very true.
It's all very
and actually quite sad,
Which, I mean, Weatherspoons
a lot of franchise pubs look the same.
It doesn't...
It's just there's no charm, really. Pubs lose their character a bit when this happens.
But then again, you've got to remember the pubs stay open and you still get your local... I mean... Let's face it, you can go anywhere. I mean, there are a lot of pub closures, but I think it's more to do with, sort of legislation and culture.
Yeah.
It's not like we all go out to the pub every night now. And we don't... What? And we don't, it's the whole, timing on that was superb.
He's drinking water.
Hmm. Every time someone drinks.
Okay, you got me on a technicality there, I guess.
I need to open up a new bottle. Hang on. It's all gone warm. It's gone warm. Can we have
bottle opening sounds?
Hang on.
Let's have a little bottle opener. Oh.
Oh, fuck me. I just came all over the place. That's foreshadowing because it's all going to go down the shitter.
I thought you were that's foreshadowing because we're all going to be jizzing all over the place. Everyone's fucking drinking in that shot. There's like three drinks there.
Oh, fuck. Oh, hang on. I'm all foam. I'll catch you up. Hang on. No, I've been... Oh. Foam isn't good. No, but like, you know...
Big Ugly Bastards wearing war paint is a foreshadowing. At this stage, I'm going to cut off the foreshadowing because...
He's drinking.
Everyone's fucking drinking from this point on.
Oh, hang on. This isn't settling. No, I'll go for the bottle.
Oh, I'm going to have a foamy kickback. Oh, no, it didn't happen.
This is awful.
Where the foam climbs up the bottleneck. Fucked. Oh, dear me. Feeling a bit bloated already.
But like, what was I talking about?
This is the problem with the drinking game commentaries. Is the fucking gross noises really do start kicking in, right? I've had a drink, their big old gulp because everyone had one.
Boo boo. Oh.
Apparently, this is a reference to Edgar Wright's childhood.
Everyone has that
that thing. I'm having issues with my headphone cables. They're just in my mouth at the minute. Sorry about that.
It's like a nickname or someone in or a slogan, you know, and it gets whittled down. Like mine and our mate Lucas, we gotta get Luke on with his commentaries.
He gets mentioned every single week, so
yeah. He's the most famous person to not be actually involved in this podcast. No, ours is back in RE. This is back at Wheatley Park School.
Religious education
for those across the pond.
And that's the other thing. Keep an eye out for numbers.
Oh, yeah.
Which is something I didn't notice until it was pointed out. We went to a Q&A.
Yeah, yeah.
They mentioned about the... it is actually an extra on the Blu-ray, but this is before the Blu-ray came out. They pointed out that each pub has the number of the pub in it.
Timing on that is superb.
Drink. So look in the set. Sometimes it's really obscure, but the number of the pub is there somewhere. If you look at Nick Frost's glasses, are the things on his glasses not level? Or is that just me?
I'll be honest with you. I was actually looking at that a few minutes ago.
It's the little pins in at the side of the front of his glasses. I swear they're not level.
Oh, God. I don't know.
It's just something... it's bugged me since the first time I watched the film. So it must actually be a thing.
It's got the Neil anal anal viewing seal of approval.
Yes.
He grabs his hand then. That's great.
No, and then Nick Frost quickly pulls his hand away as well.
No, it's back in our RE class in Wheatley Park School, they had these old, like, sort of really nasty little buildings left over from the Second World War that were used as, like, religious education classes. And our classes weren't great. The syllabus was terrible. We didn't really do anything there. I can't remember. You know, all I did was basically sit there and leer at the teachers, but...
Yeah.
Which is quite bad. But there was a big... There was this really...
I have an RE school teacher story. I'll tell it in a minute.
Yeah. Is Rawson.
Yeah.
And
probably shouldn't give a name, but yeah.
At the very back of one of Mrs. Rawson's poster.
How many times am I gonna have to beep that fucking name out? Stop using a name. Give a different name.
Okay. Mrs. Teacher.
Mrs. Rawnchy, because that was her first name.
You're actually gonna beep that out.
I might. I'll think if I remember.
Yeah,
I might get to the stage where I'm editing the podcast because it'd be like 10 months time or something, yeah. And I'll be like, oh,
no. Look. Anyway, no. There's this poster at the back of the wall. It just says, "Apathy is not an option." For fucking years, like, you know, it got to be because like, I go up to Luke's like, "Apathy is not an option." He's like, "You're damn right, it's not an option." So then it sort of boiled down. It's like, if I go up to Luke's like, "It's not an option." He's like, damn right it's not an option. We're talking about apathy. Apathy is not an option. It is a very good option, but there you go. That was a crap story. There was something I was talking about earlier. I don't know what it was.
Other raunchy, Miss Raunchy stories.
She's a good teacher.
I can't remember a single thing she ever taught me for two reasons.
Saying that to counteract the fact that we're going to tell this next story. She was an absolutely beautiful lady.
She was. I mean, so and... you know, I mean, obviously, when you're fucking a horny, out of control teenager,
you're fucking an all. You're
attracted to absolutely everything with tits. But she was, she must have been like fresh out of teacher training. She couldn't have been teaching very long. She was in her 20s, and she seated everyone. She had selected places for our class, at least. Sat me right at the front. And it became a thing where she would drop pencils and then be bending down to pick them up, either straight down the top, I could see, or, you know, it was all asses, you know. It was definite stuff going on there. It was just, and it always right in front of me, never in front of anyone else. And the first person to notice this was our friend Gary, and he sort of said, have you ever noticed how she's always doing this sort of stuff in front of you? And, yeah. And then I probably had, but wasn't really saying anything, so I probably kind of liked it. But after that point, it just got ridiculously embarrassing every single time. And then she'd sort of, like, be talking to the class, and she'd lean on my desk, and it's just like, all I can see is breasts. And she's teaching the rest of the class. It was uncomfortable. not the most. And you're right in front of the class. It's not like you have nowhere else to look.
It was
both amazing and horrific at the same time. I don't for a minute think she was doing it intentionally. I don't think she noticed, but it was a constant sort of, and everyone sort of made jokes about me, you know, if I had a pack of Rolos or something, I'd give her my last Rolo because it's fucking raunchy. That was a name, yeah. Hopefully she's teaching somewhere else and she's doing very well for herself. She's probably happily married with a couple of sprogs of her own or something. But yeah, that was that.
Should we go back? There's gonna be like
drinking
5 minutes
through a straw.
5 minutes of silence. David Bradley. I love David Bradley. After watching that Adventures in a Through Space and Time, that Doctor Who thing, what a fucking performance. He's just so good.
I love that.
Bard for life.
Yeah. They had a viral trailer of this where you could link the trailer to your Facebook profile.
Right.
And the end result of the trailer was that you would be barred from that pub as well, because it'd take one of your pictures from your Facebook page and put it onto that wall.
I love this song, Stone Roses.
This is Pearls, a pretty Pearls. Amazing song, and he's about to drink those pints in the background. So. Two, and he's out of frame, thank God. I always watch the windows here because you can see him running. There he goes.
I missed that. Whee!
You see him running like around. That's a reference to the future, but we're not drinking to that anymore. But just so you know, it's there.
It sounds like fucking Zoidberg.
It does sound like Zoidberg, yeah.
It's a good impression. I love the hoodies.
What is it about pub chips? I mean, pubs just seem to do good chips.
It's because they deep fat fry them, and most people do them in the oven because, let's face it, deep frying a chip at home, it's, you know, you've got to really want it.
I guess it seems kind of fitting that all we're talking about is like things that are relevant to British culture while we're watching this film, but it's chip good. Shops are everywhere here, about the same as pubs. You get chip shops, there are chip shops where chips just aren't good, and there are chip shops where chips are amazing. But pub chips always seem to work well. It must be something to do with a combination of chips and alcohol. It must just be...
Salt. They're laden with salt.
Yeah, but there's salt in chip shop chips. That's not a thing. It's something to do with the way they're cooked, what they're cooked in, and the thickness of the chip.
It's about chip science.
There is chip science out there, people. It's the thickness of the chip. It's how dense the potato is inside... The fried casing of your chip, the golden.
I'm giving you background chip science music.
And you know, if you have your chip science worked out well, if its molecular structure is perfect and it's properly down scientifically, you've got a perfect chip. Not many people can nail the perfect scientific chip, but pubs seem to be able to, and everyone's
drinking.
Right,
fuck it. We're drinking a few there.
Is this the actor you were talking about the other day?
Can't remember his name.
Who said he was the other sniper in...
Four Lions,
with Kevin Eldon.
Yeah.
Who we mentioned in... That was the Hot Fuzz commentary. I brought that up, wasn't it? I hope that was a commentary thing. That was just a private conversation. But I think it was the commentary.
It was the commentary.
Oh, I better hope so. That's the other thing I missed.
That's a good reference,
because
that's obviously straight out of his...
Yeah. There aren't so many references in this to the other two films, which they did intentionally. There is little bits there. It's much more subtle. But they intentionally wanted to move away, I think, from the formula of... Yeah, see, they're not level. The glasses thing. It's going to bug me forever. Why aren't they level? I don't get
it. This is weird. I like the fact we've dipped into like our old school stories in this commentary completely.
That is fucking weird. It's made us think of old... Yeah, that's because we were talking about wanting to be young, I guess. And it sort of triggered that off. Oh, I've got gas in the pit of my stomach.
He's got it in his ass. He's got an ass gas.
I'm going to blow one way or another at some point in this podcast.
Chip signs. Going back to your chip signs thing, right? It's okay, think about it. You've got to think what's in common, right? What they all have in common. They all deep fry their chips, and they all do it from frozen.
They all deep fry their cheap.
They all deep fry their cheap. And cheap. All right, are we drinking? Oh, fuck.
No, he hasn't had a drink. Oh, they have to drink on screen, according to your drinking water rules.
You said every time someone has a drink, you drink. I had a drink, you got a better drink.
No, it doesn't work that way.
I'm the technicality.
Like you're
bastard.
Too gay for comfort bottle opening. I didn't drink for that either.
Hang out.
Ooh.
Strange. Ooh, I've changed. No one wants to hit me, fucking.
You're just gonna,
look at that old retro phone, love it.
Yeah. And this is part of like what I said about how the technology in this, I don't think it'll date too much. You've got the headset there, but.
Yeah. Clever, actually.
There isn't too much technology. Like, even the car is old and everything, so just the nature of it, it feels old school, even though it's not.
Yeah. These films won't date. And that's a very good, you know, sign.
Maybe the price on that fucking... a little bit of advertising on the table might change, but that's probably dated already.
Join society. Don't be a part of society!
We're in the cross hands now, aren't we? We're about to have our first fight.
This is when he goes for the...
Yeah, he's going to the... Yeah, okay. This is where the film gets really good, in my opinion. It's good up until this point, but this is where it takes this extra step for me.
And it's just like,
the pacing really kicks off, and this is when it gets really interesting, and... It's just... Yeah. at the end of this review, if I remember, I've got on my computer, I've got this email from my mum. I got my mum to write a review of this film... for this commentary, so if I remember at the end of the review, I'll read Neil's mum's review of The World's End, because my mum was a huge fan of this. She's a huge fan of all three, but this one in particular, she's very taken with.
Any particular reason?
I mean, she sort of explains it in her review, really, but I think the thing that mum likes more than anything else is characters who you have to kind of struggle to enjoy. Deeply flawed individuals is something she enjoys. Like, she reads a lot of books. It's a thing in books she likes to read about. All of her favourite TV
you
shows.
Say that as if, like, I don't know, these book things, you know, that people go on about. I don't read books. I don't know what these things are. I've heard about them. Whatever.
I don't read many books, it has to be said. Not because I can't read. It's just because I can't...
There's never enough time.
It's part of me. I mean, it's something... It's something... I'm not... Like, I don't hide or anything. I am a bit dyslexic, so I struggle with things like maths and English and spelling and reading and things like that a little bit. I can read and I can write fairly...
English is pretty damn good, mind.
I've worked out a way around it, but when it comes to reading, the idea of... Well, not the idea, but actually the practice of reading and at the same time imagining what's happening is something that my brain can't quite put together, so... Either way, and away from this boring fucking personal stuff, let's talk about the awesome fight sequence that this is. Because the fight sequences in this film are amazing. And for those of you keeping up with Neil's stepdad laughs moments...
Really?
That's a moment my stepdad found particularly hysterical. Because it's a bit over the top violent.
I love the fact they look... Oh, God, like that... That sort of blue round thing, it looks like fucking like...
Like an action man. Like when you pop an arm off an action man, that's essentially what's behind it. I think that was the idea for the design.
Oh, my mind didn't go there. My mind went to sort of like big bulky sort of gymnastics equipment that had like big plasticky kind of things.
I hate I hate to put a downer on your take on it, but I think mine might be more close to the truth.
Yes,
what
I think
they were going for.
I think so.
Action figures and stuff.
Oh, that actually, that never twigged until you said it. But no, you're right. I just have a weird thing. It also kind of reminds me of urinals.
Like urinal cakes or something.
Probably because there's urinals right next to it. Yeah.
But as I was saying, the
I love this.
The fight sequences in this are great. The guy they got to choreograph the fight sequences was a part of Jackie Chan's stunt team, so they have that Jackie Chan feel to them that they wanted. The whole
lots of character,
lots of character within the fight, lots of prop involvement, and lots of one continuous shot. Yeah. And this fight takes place almost entirely in what looks like one shot, which is also really cool.
I love the fact Gary goes first. He's like, he's straight in there.
Oh, and we have to drink every time someone loses a limb. I didn't drink for that head coming off, by the way.
Oh, I did.
Well done, you. I missed it. I was too busy talking about stuff.
Right, but we're going to have there, a few limbs cover me for a second now. Or two.
I'm nearly out of this can.
I'm like about 3 pints in.
Oh, a limb. There we go.
Right.
And now from this point on in the fight, Gary pretty much is only having a fight with that arm. This is still the same shot, kind of. It's not actually the same shot.
I'm sure they must have cut
lots of. Yeah, there's lots of different shots pieced together. But that's the first cut.
Christ, I love this because this makes me look at film and it just excites me. You know,
yeah.
This is all, and this is the best thing to compare this to is From Dusk Till Dawn, that moment where it flips.
Suddenly, there's vampires involved.
Yeah,
yeah.
I love that. I love the fact you can get taken so far into a story, and then you can just be just completely taken a different direction. And I like the fact that
bang,
you know. I
love
the
Gary.
Sorry,
I love the fact it's almost like, because we were watching Kiss Kiss Bang Bang last night. Yeah, literally, we record these like back to back, whatever.
Yeah,
but like
what? That we didn't record one for?
Oh, God. Kiss, Kiss, Bang, Bang. It's getting in there. It's getting into my system now. Oh, the liquor. I'm rubbing my chest. No one can see that.
That was funny because I wasn't looking at Guy and I didn't know he was doing it. There's an arm.
Like, it goes from nothing, them having a bitch about Gary, to them effectively killing 5 very bizarre young teenagers. What happened?
Yeah.
Extreme circumstances.
I mean, that's why WTF is what you're supposed
to be. I love this line.
That's a very good gag. But yeah, you're supposed to be. Supposed to what you're supposed to be saying. It's a shame that it was. The trailers gave that twist away because you knew there were aliens involved in it. And I think the shot with the head was used in publicity as well.
And they're right back. It's like.
But if I wanted. And I really tried. But Guy and I went to see This Is the End. And there was a fucking trailer for this at the start of it. It was the first time I saw the trailer for it.
Oh, right.
I was sort of forced to fucking watch the thing. And I was trying really hard not to see a trailer for it.
And they're all
And then
the
it
phones.
Gave it away. And I was like, oh, shit. But if I went in completely blind, that would have been, oh, holy shit. This film just got really fucking weird really quickly.
Yeah.
And I wish I'd have seen it like that. Best way to see this film would be without knowing anything about it. Oh god, this gas! I need release at some point.
Dude, you can fart, but let's face it.
No, it's not allowing me yet.
Oh, it's one of them.
If I were to do it, it'd just be shitting on the floor.
I'll be honest with you. I'd rather move that DVD case before you're going to do it.
Your DVD case under there today.
There's a Dad's Army, dude. DVD. Oh, it's happened.
What, Dad's Army? What the? Oh, your
my CD wallet.
I'll kick it out of the way.
All right.
Oh yeah. So if I
shit away,
I mean,
sir,
that'd be shit.
Shit away.
If I were to hit great that shot. Far away, I'd have great to be shitting shot. Like a machine gun.
I love the lighting in this. In this, all the pub stuff.
Yeah.
Great. So much character, and all the wood and stuff. Yeah, it's good. I love it. Very normal. And I like the. It's like they got fucking snooker on the TV as well.
Yeah.
It's crazy. Like if you look at. Oh, okay. You can tell I'm getting a bit pissed because I was fucking. Shit hot before we started this, and now I'm getting a little bit pissed.
Drink, and is Gary going to drink? He has to drink.
Ugh, all right.
Oh,
that's
no,
a good couple of extra ones. This is nice beer, man. Kingfisher's good.
I am enjoying my Magnus, but the problem with cider is it's very gassy. That's gonna be like at the end of the climax of this podcast. It's just one, gonna be a massive fart. Or... It's five, isn't it? Right. Okay. I'm just gonna have a big old gulp of this.
I need a top up. I'm doing it so like, yeah,
You know, once we've done like 10 of these, we have
to. It's got ink on our hand. No. Neil, I can tell I'm pissed because it's starting to affect me.
We have to, once we've done like 10 of these, we have to have a compilation of all the random guttural noises that we've made while drinking. Oh, fuck.
Right. You've got no idea, guys. You look so uncomfortable. It's crazy. This is good. I'm getting
I feel like my stomach is like four times the size it usually is. And imagine that. It'd be fucking huge.
I'll be honest with you. I can't remember the last time I had anything to drink. It's been a good fucking few months.
Last time I had a drink, I think I went out for a drink with some workmates.
Pre-Christmas, like, though.
Yeah, this would have been about 3 months before. So.
Before Christmas, or?
A drink up. There we go.
Okay, for anyone that hasn't, and let's face it, everybody has. Except for Neil, apparently.
Yeah.
Let's keep fuck, right. The first Doors album is an absolute masterpiece. It is just dip into it. It's got a whiskey bar on it. Just go into it.
It's the only song in this soundtrack that doesn't fit the time period as well.
Yeah, okay.
But they felt they had to use it because it was so incredibly fitting.
Because let's face it, the song is incredible.
Oh, shit. We're at the good... Oh, fuck. I've got most of a can in my hand.
Oh!
Oh, fuck. Right, I might as well start this now.
He's getting the eye. Tell you. What are you doing? All right, if you're drinking, I've got a drink.
No, it's because they're about to die on their pints. So... Oh, I said I would finish whatever drink I had in my hand. I opened this one and I was about... It's hard to describe. I must be about an inch into this can. But they're about to down a pint, so I have to finish this one. Because I said I would.
Oh, fuck.
Oh, you should fuck her now.
It's that... Okay, this is us. It's that signature... It's that... You know you do that bit... Guy's slurring his words. Guy's fucked up. You know you do that bit there.
But yeah, I'm like, doing...
You do that guttural bit. That's the signature thing I think about when I think about the drinking commentaries.
Yeah, we do it at each. I'm about to do it again now because I've got to finish this can off before they start drinking again.
He's done it as well, man. Neil wins a prize. Guy's getting slightly more pissed. This is... Typical Edgar Wright shooting, and I love it. Drink.
Oh, shit. Right, okay. Let's listen. How does this one sound? Give it the...
Oh, God.
Courtesy tap.
The Percy tap? The
courtesy tap.
The Percy tap?
The Percy tap. What, the shitty Fat Tank Engine?
You went to Thomas the Tank Engine as well. Dude, I went Thomas the Tank Engine in my head. I wanted to see where you went. We win everything! Guy's getting drunk!
Right, I need a drink because I missed that one that Guy just took, so I'll drink there.
Oh, what happened?
Oh, fucking hell.
Neil needs to fart. I need to piss. It's all fun.
You can piss if you want. I think you're okay for drinks.
Do you reckon, like, the people listening...
That's the other thing about the drinking and commentaries.
Did you say cockatrees?
Something like that. It always gets to the stage where you need to go and piss... And then you go away and then you come back. And I'm sure Neil said really shitty things about me, and he did that in one of them, I think. Did I go for a piss in the basketball one? I think I did. I might have done. I was pretty fucking hammered.
The world went for a piss in the basketball one. Peter Green.
I'm so glad no one's drinking on screen right now.
I'm so happy I remember the name. Right, yeah. This is what happens. I purposefully. I'm reaching. I'm getting all the fucking. Wait. Okay.
Guy just picked up a bottle opener. I thought he picked up a thermometer. I didn't know what the fuck was going on.
It's your bottle opener. Neil's got this fucking sexy ass Carlsberg thing. It's a bottle opener. It's, like,
it's a really simple. It's essentially just a long rectangle, smooth out rectangle.
But listen to this, right? I shouldn't do this one.
That so won't be audible.
It will. Look. It's picking up. I can see it picking up. What a fucking bitching ass sound. It looks really good. What's going on?
I kind of feel like Nick Frost at this moment because I didn't feel that drunk until he started drinking. And now I'm
not
really
going. I'm not going. The guy doesn't really know what's happening in the film anymore.
My eyes have stopped being in time with my brain.
Sexy people.
Is a random little like cameo essentially.
What's that guy's name? Nicholas.
The guy from Nathan Barley.
Fuck Nick. Nicholas begins with a B. Fuck. I'm gonna have to
Yeah, I can't remember his name, but it's a random little role that he's in this.
Yeah.
Now number six.
Is that when we drink?
In the back. Drink! No.
Do you get comfy?
You're just drinking. What? A bold man handing you your phone and you're like, oh, drink and 2K for comfort.
I'll be honest with you, Neil, I'm not really paying attention anymore. This is what an empty stomach does to
a man. I'm still
trying
to keep up. I've probably missed a drinking moment, so I am going to have a drink. But
I love that.
Fuck. Oh, why did I drink then? Here we are. David Smiley just had a drink. So
I want to say Nicholas Bevan, but that's a producer. An amalgamation of a...
That's Tim Bevan, isn't it?
That's Tim Bevan. That's what I'm thinking.
Producer of this, I do believe.
Yes, indeed. I'm thinking Nicholas.
Right, from this point on, Martin Freeman is a blank. And you can tell because his earpiece is always blinking.
In the toilet.
His earpiece is always blinking blue from this point on.
Oh, Christ, what's the guy's name? That's going to bug me. Nicholas, and it's B.
Oh, drink.
Yeah, right.
Gary King just finished his pint.
He does act completely differently. Right, okay, let's work this out. Let's go back. Oh, hang on. World's End film. Fuck it, the soundtrack.
Oh, we're going to have a fight sequence in this as well.
Burns! Nicholas Burns! Christ, guy! Yeah, Nicholas Burns. If you haven't seen...
Mark Heap! Been watching some Big Train recently, and Mark Heap is awesome. This is they were trying to get him into every one of these Cornetto trilogy films, but he just wasn't available until this one. But he's one of the actors that probably would have been in each one because they're very tight knit with him because he was in Spaced.
Yeah,
I love that.
What?
Nick just laughing. At him. It's really good.
I need to get more beers.
Oh, I think I might need.
Knock him out, boys. Mark Heap, for anyone that doesn't know, was the voice of Stressed Eric.
Oh, I didn't know he'd voice that. I got a drink.
Drinking, yeah. Do you remember Stressed Eric?
You played me. Oh shit! I just knocked my mic stand. Sorry, people.
For anyone that doesn't know, Stressed Eric was a cartoon.
Oh, my brain.
I'm gonna trivia bomb your ass. Oh, look, I'm not that drunk. So I can still type it in. Stressed. Oh, look, it comes up. If you type in stressed to Google.
Eric
iPad,
is one of the first few, is it?
Well, it's the fourth one.
Fourth
stressed
one.
Eric. Let's do some website. Stressed Eric was a cartoon that... It was a British-American / New Zealand cartoon series that was produced by Absolutely Productions for the BBC Two television channel, United Kingdom and Television New Zealand. The series revolves around Eric Feeble, a middle-class man who is always stressed because of the family work, co-workers, etc. The animation for the series was carried out by American studio Klasky Cuspo. As in Rugrats.
Oh, yeah, right.
Holy shit! We're trivia fucking all over this place.
Trivia fucking... New name for the podcast. We're not going to call it commentaries anymore. It's going to be called Trivia Fucking.
It's not Expo. It's not a commentary. We're Trivia Fucking. Isn't Rosamund Pike very cute?
I knew you were going to go from fucking to fucking Rosamund Pike in that moment.
I'm a
dick. I could see that happening. She is rather attractive. Even for a lady, but she's doing well for her age as well.
Shit, that's harsh thing
to say. Sorry, Rosamund Pike. Not that she's fucking listening to this fucking
cunt. How do you know?
I would love it. Like,
you're going to get an email from Raunchy Rawson next week, so shut your face.
Oh, fucking how amazing would it be?
Neil, it was like on purpose.
Here's a nipple shot just for you. Oh, fuck, that would mess my brain up so much.
It won't happen, but...
I think this is the moment that I had my mum's biggest laugh. The whole bit. I'm not proud of it. Oh, I am a little bit. Oh, I love that.
That's a great gag. I love the twins. Great. Right. Who else was in it?
What do you think you should have... What would you have called the aliens Or Blanks robots, good, had it been. You think Blanks is good, or would you have got... I do quite like Smashy Smashy Eggman.
That is pretty good. Respectful of neighbours. That's a pub. Okay, I'm going to bring that up. The Star in Oxford. One of our favourite pubs.
Yes, located just off the Cowley Road in Oxford.
Mm-hmm. Check it out.
Is it still there?
Yeah, the Star still. It's a fucking dynamite pub.
Cool.
But they've got a big old beer garden. It's quite it's not suburban, but there's a lot of houses around there. But they've done a thing. I love this fight scene sequence.
It's this is really imaginative, this.
Yes, exactly. Imaginative. That's a great word. Just it's like,
that someone's about to lose their head. Boom. At this point, I'm going to mention...
Look at the horror.
It came to the stage where I knew my mum had to see this, right? I'm not going to keep talking about my mum. Jesus. But, like, I had to... And this is slightly illegal. But I did have... I did basically have to...
Don't tell me I'm drinking.
I had to rip the film to my computer and re-edit it in Final Cut Pro.
Why?
Because my mum has a phobia of masks.
Oh,
now,
right, the mask thing. Right.
This is... let me describe that for people who don't know what that means. Basically, if there is something wrong with a human's face or it's been altered in any way, it freaks my mum out. It's a genuine proper phobia she has. It really, really worries her and she gets upset. So I saw this film knowing that she'd seen both Shaun of the Dead and Hot Fuzz. Now, Shaun of the Dead she can barely get through for that reason. Hot Fuzz she can get through. No, just because of the mask. Yeah, the eyes. She can't see the eyes.
Oh, what? The contact lenses?
Yeah, freaks her out. Okay. So, but she can get through that. She knows to look away. But in this, I really wanted her to see this because I knew she'd like it. But there's many scenes in this where you need to see what's happening when the aliens have lost features and stuff. Like when Martin Freeman loses half of his face, for example. You need to see it. And I knew that my mum had to see it. So I had to import the film. I had to rip it off a copy, put it on my computer, pop it into Final Cut Pro, and blur every single image of a mutated human's head in the entire thing. And now this sequence in particular was really hard to edit because every time you see her face from this point onwards, I had to blur it. So just imagine watching this fight sequence with the robot's face blurred out. It took a hell of a lot of time to edit, and it was a right pain in the ass. But it resulted in my mum being able to see it, so it was worth it. So, yeah, that's just a little bit of added information. Guy's actually in the... I need beers.
I'll get you more beers,
Neil. Thank you, just get them.
Yeah, I'm there for you!
Just get the rest of them from the fucking kitchen, and we'll have sexy times together. I think he's about to rip her head off, so that'll be a drink for when Guy comes back. You're okay, you've only missed one. Ugh.
How do we get so drunk? Right, fuck it, my flies aren't getting done up. I'm in that much of a hurry.
Guy's just had a piss and he's not bothering to do his flies up, so he's just going to walk in with his dick flopping around inside my living room. The audience... I genuinely
Neil,
looked
is
as...
a beer.
Thank you.
No, you drink cider. You'll drink cider.
The audience will be genuinely upset to hear that Guy's dick isn't flopping around.
Right, my original gag was this is what I had planned. Right, I should have caught on to this about. I didn't realize the story would drag on. Right, so like. I'm going to listen back. I want to find out the story. But
well, hey, look, people don't listen to these particular commentaries for, like, coherent stories because it will inevitably get to a stage where we can't possibly do it anymore.
I know. I'm just drinking. Not because I had to drink because I missed a few shots, but because I like drinking. Right, anyway. Anyway, my sexy fucking plan was to come... Wait, I'm going to still do it. My plan
You
was
know
to...
what? I'm actually... Oof. Come on, spit your words out. Right. Neil, focus. I'm going to use this bit to go and take a piss myself. Guy.
Oh, good God, man. You can use a table. Right.
I'm going to go and take a piss and leave you with God.
Sexy plan, right? My plan, right? I did it all like it was. I had fucking hand movements and I was like, wait. Neil's telling a story. I was like, fucking. You I'm sort of playing up a little bit, only a little bit. But anyway. Right. This online dictionary wants to mean to install a mobile app, and I don't want to do that. I feel offended. No, my plan, I could see things better if I know my contacts. And my plan, as Dave Bradley, Dave Bradley's fucking awesome, and this scene is quite funny. Why do you think I've been drinking through a straw? My plan was to go rock a quick piss, to a long piss, grab some beers, and be back in here by the time Neil finished his story. And then I was going to give you all a definition of the word opportunity. And then I thought that'd be kind of like twatty and sort of egotistical and funny. And it is going to be, because I'm going to fucking give you a definition of the word opportunity anyway. A favorable or advantageous circumstance or combination of circumstances. I'm so happy I managed to say that. A favorable or suitable occasion or time. Two, a change for progress or advancement. Now, fucking hell, that's pretty damn fine. I'm lost on the film, I'll be honest with you. My headphones on the floor, I don't know what's going on. I had a dynamite piss, though. Neil fucking probably rocked a decent fart.
How the fuck am I supposed to get back in this out?
Are you really that pissed already?
Yeah, a bit. It was more because I'd been sat.
And you got up. And you
got up. You might be able to, but it's because I've been sat in the same chair for ages. And I hadn't moved. And my legs weren't as strong as I used to.
I like the one with the curly hair best.
Alright, okay, let's bring this down.
I'll go far right. It's my favourite.
Oh, the marmalade sandwich. Far right. At that moment, I had to see him again.
Right, there was. I'm sure there's a lot of things.
I got me some custard cream.
You got a custard cream?
I have.
You just said that. You'd be like, oh, a custard cream. You seem so proud of it. And then you took a bite, and all the crumbs went down your shit. You bastards. Yourself, haven't you?
Don't make me laugh. I'm going to spit custard cream into my microphone.
They just want to make us more like them. Oh, there you go.
Far right. All right, which is right. My right.
How many drinks? I'll be honest with you. I may have slightly lost track of what's going on. So I'm going to drink quite a bit now.
Right. I don't think I've got any open beers. So I'm going to have to open another one. You know what that means.
Ah.
Oh, yeah. Fun times. Podcast is recording, right? Don't do that to me.
Sorry about that.
Fucking hell. Ominous silence was not what I was
this
after
is
at that stage.
She fucking swallows his ring.
How's that creepy?
No, it's not creepy. It's
well, the
like,
entire idea is a bit creepy, but...
It's like... It's shit, man.
Did I miss any drinks?
Okay, this is the thing, right? Anything that goes in your mouth...
I'm gonna say yes.
Anything... Don't ask me that! He's funny. He makes me laugh.
Vanishes into the night like Batman. Right.
No, like no. The whole thing.
I'm still
about
trying
the,
to establish which one's the hottest of my in my opinion.
In the marmalade sandwich. Rosamund
Pike. No, she's not in there. Okay.
Well, she's the hottest, but oh, we're
Martin Freeman.
Now.
Oh, he's not the hottest.
Oh, it's so creepy.
That guy. He's pretty attractive. I mean, he's a dude. I'm not gay. I'm not gay, but.
Fuck, man, he's cute, though, eh? He's got that fucking Alexander Skarsgård.
He has got, on. Yeah, ruggedly handsome.
Let's face it, if you're going to go gay, you've got to go Scandinavian.
Yeah.
And if you're straight, you're going to go Scandinavian.
Right, okay.
Fuck!
I don't think I'm going to get a good shot of these.
Neil, say... say your most British fuck. What? Say in your most British...
Oh, fuck.
Oh, fuck! Fuck this. No, that was terrible.
I'm a fucking genius, is what I am.
I'm Neil. I will inflate my ego.
And my chest, apparently.
I have to lean back from the mic for that.
And rub your nipple. What was that? I'm rubbing my nipple. Guy inflates his chest, puts his hand right on his nipple, and it's just like they're like, I inflate my ego.
It's not a nipple, it's the cross that I've got. You just fucking went on foot one on Jesus, man.
In order to inflate your ego, you have to touch Jesus.
No, I've got a cross dangling, it's in underneath my t-shirt, and it's like
It's over his pectoral muscle.
I forgot I was wearing that. I like the timing on the fucking walks.
Yeah, there's whole training footage of them doing that as well. They had to learn to be completely in time and things like that.
Oh, wait a minute. I shouldn't mind that.
The gas.
Good stuff.
The gas seemed to exit my stomach when I pissed. I didn't have a fart. I don't think I burped. Burped. That's fun to say, burped. What a weird thing to fucking say.
I think we're going to keep going with this. You know one of those things where you're at the supermarket and you think, is this going to be enough alcohol? And you buy a lot of alcohol and you think, I'll buy a bit more.
Oh, this will be enough. We'll be fine. I need my headphones on.
How long have we been doing this?
I don't know, because I can't see the timer on the fucking player now.
An hour and 10 minutes.
Are we
at the Beehive? We're at the Beehive.
We are, which is the biggest fight sequence in the game.
Look at the carpet. The carpet's very
big. We're about to see fucking Pierce Brosnan.
Sip of wine.
I've only got sound coming from one side of my earphones now.
Oh, really?
Yeah. I must have worked the cable loose with my feet or something.
Please.
Not that I'm bothered. It's fine. I don't really need to be able to hear it at this stage. I'm a bit too gone to... Oh, he's drinking. Oh, he spit. It still counts. Fuck it. Ooh, yoy. Who had the genius idea to do a drinking game for this commentary? I know. Stupid fucking
idiot. I love it. Like, okay. Mr. Shepherd, actually, I got two things, right?
Pierce Brosnan. I don't know if he said his name.
Pierce Brosnan. If you like Pierce Brosnan as an actor, check out The Matador. It is an exceptional film.
Yeah.
And I'm going to feel bad because I've forgotten the name of the guy that wrote and directed it, Stevens. I'm going to look that up right now.
Oh, he's going to get his iPad out and have a type, so I'm going to talk in the meantime.
And the other thing was, doesn't he remind you of Mr. Brown from Physics?
No.
All right, well, fuck you. Mr. Brown was one of our
teachers.
He was the best teacher at Wheatley Park. He used to teach physics. Are we drinking? Right.
Oh, yeah, I don't know why I did that. Fuck.
You're doing it to me. You're doing it
for me. I am. I'm just randomly drinking now. I'm really hot. Not in a sexy way. Pierce Brosnan. He was James Bond. Was playing
Richard Shepherd. Richard Shepherd. I'm so sorry, Richard. You make terrible films.
Another person. We've learned that Rosamund Pike, Raunchy Rawson, and Pierce Brosnan. No, Stephen. Who?
Richard Shepherd.
Richard Shepherd listens to our podcast during the course of this podcast.
Neil's funny right now.
Pierce Brosnan. Someone lost half of their head.
Imagine that. Fuck. Like that.
What the fuck?
Holy shit. All right. Look at this. So good.
And obviously, right now, when it came to editing this for my mum, every single face you can see in this sequence had to be blurred out. This was a fucking nightmare.
Looks really young there. Oh, fuck off, Brosnan. I was adulting, man.
He was...
I fucking hate this town.
Great soundbite.
Amazing.
And this is my favourite fight in the film.
Oh.
This is just brilliant. Oh, we've lost like three heads.
Yeah.
Another two. And sixth. And a drink. Oh, fucking Peg, man. Jesus. Right, okay.
I'm back.
Don't rip off any limbs or knock off any heads at this moment in time, please, mister.
I got a top up. I'm out. Yeah, Richard Shepherd. Sorry about that, man. Like, fucking...
I thought you'd finished that thought.
No, seriously. There's another really cracking film I watched recently called The Hunting Party. Richard Gere. It's all about...
Two. As a hand. And a forearm and a head gone there.
I got a head. I'm waiting for... I go put another beer.
And a head. Oh, can I just point out that fucking Simon Pegg's work with this pint glass is...
Super.
This is the most Jackie Chan fight in the entire thing, mainly for his work with this pint. This is is such a Jackie Chan thing to have. Like, there's the bit in Rush Hour where he's trying to stop the vase from breaking. It's very much like that, and then it eventually breaks. It's a genius. Love it.
Mm. Seriously,
I think I had about three
if
mouthfuls.
You love your films,
I missed.
Check out The Matador. It's Greg Kinnear and Pierce Brosnan. Greg Kinnear. Let's face it. Greg Kinnear is a fucking solid actor, man. Like, if you need a great supporting actor, you get Greg Kinnear, man. He's fucking dope in that film. Basically, the premise is Pierce Brosnan and it's
head.
Oh, where's my beer? And Pierce Brosnan plays a hitman who he's having a bit of a
oh, and an arm. Well, Martin Freeman, stop losing fucking pieces of your body, man. Keep yourself together, man.
Imagine that. Imagine you looking at your brother. Who?
I find that very hard to imagine. But keep going.
You have no siblings. All right.
That was like a very harsh and very true statement. You have no siblings.
You can put it on a t-shirt if you want, man. No, seriously. Right,
someone's lost
a
leg.
Right, there's a limb. Fuck it. Oh.
The limb thing I came up with literally
okay.
last minute.
Do you know
I'm
what?
Kinda regretting
it,
that
right?
Decision.
The stories aren't going to get told. Watch The Matador by Richard Shepherd. It is fucking excellent.
If they all put
also
their limbs back on, does that mean
Barty.
We get to regurgitate the pints? Sorry, keep going.
Check them out. I should probably watch out, because I don't know what happened in the film. I need to open more beer.
Right. You want me to update you on the plot? Basically, everyone knows exactly what's going on
Wait. Just give me the number of the beehive. Is that beehive 7 or 8? Or 9?
Oh, I want to say 8, but I could be wrong.
I'm surprised I got one of the two. Oh, wait, I was supposed to do it in front. Oh, I missed the hit. You guys missed the hiss. Sounding bad.
Oh, stop burping all over the fucking place right now.
Drinking commentary. This is probably the most fun I've had yet.
Right, okay, we're going to have some more
drinking
in this sequence because I do believe this guy loses a head. Oof, there it goes. Oh, and a half a body, that's two. Oh, fuck. And this isn't a bad gag either, this thing about him, like... I, you know, in jumping off and landing on the roof, this was ruined by the trailers.
Because
it was in all the trailers. But it's a really good gag. It's sort of akin to, like, the whole, like, Del Boy falling through the barn thing. Like, you kind of know it's coming, but it's really clever and really funny. The timing of it's perfect.
Although, when
good physical
fucking
comedy.
Peck died... We had, I came down to work and we had like Only Fools and Horses playing on thing. And fucking ignorantly, I was like, oh great, we're playing Only Fools and Horses on the TV. Great, that doesn't mean, that means we fucking lose the Doctor Who or that we don't. But the Hunger Games catching fire again. And it was like,
I wish the Hunger
no,
Games.
No, Roger
fire.
Peck died. Oh, fucking, that sucks ass. But like, so we had like the best of. And of course, you got the episode, you know, with the fucking housing meeting where he's like, oh, why'd you call me Dave? My name's Rodney.
Yeah.
And the whole falling through the bar scene. It was on the TVs down the DVD floor. And like, as soon as it came on, everyone would sort of stop and watch it. Because everyone knew it was going to happen.
Yeah, oh, it's that bit where he falls through the bar, yeah.
Absolutely incredible. What a fucking incredible moment. Like, Only Fools and Horses. For those across the pond, or anyone who hasn't seen it, I'm sure you probably filmed through by now, but check out a British comedy There's the Fence Joe.
Yeah, every single film has one. I'm going to drink to it, even though it doesn't
even
drink.
Fine.
Just because it's the biggest running gag in the entire franchise, really.
The ball's green. How is that going to translate across the pond? It's very British.
That's a good point, actually. They won't know. I guess they
just
think...
What's a ball's green? It's grass.
And you can't even say it's like a cricket pavilion because people wouldn't know what that is either.
Pavilion. That's a word that gets me a little bit hard.
The word pavilion gets
you. You don't know the word pavilion?
It's
What an evocative word. What an evocative British word. You know, the word pavilion.
It's not a bad word. I don't have a problem with it. I don't know. It just doesn't do anything for me in particular. I guess those in like who like long sort of like lyrically sounding words, it would get them erect or as wet as Niagara Falls. Or
I used to love being. I was always. I used to love being D'Artagnan.
What? What, when you played as a kid?
Yeah. You didn't play Three Musketeers as a kid?
I don't think so.
Bear in mind, like, when I was about... Wait, let me do the maths. Gloucester. Late 80s, 89.
Oh, shot. Sorry, I did start.
Fuck, hang on. 89 or so. We're talking Dogtanyan. Do you remember Dogtanyan?
I do. It's an early morning cartoon that was on Channel 4
for ages.
Same time as people might be more familiar with the Peter Pan cartoon with Tim Curry's Captain Hook.
It was played about the same time as that on Channel 4 in this country.
And but yeah, Dogtanyan, like, so like that was around when I was very, very young, and like, fuck, we're reaching back. Fuck it, I'm not gonna go to that story because that's a fucking. I'm gonna fucking shoot myself in the face. But
did you say shoot yourself or shit yourself? Because shit yourself would be fucking hilarious to watch.
I'm gonna shit myself in her face. Allah. I'm gonna make it happen. I used to like. I was always D'Artagnan. D'Artagnan's the fucking hero, man. He's fucking. He's the spirit.
Oh, I forgot this one was open.
Oh my god! Honest to god, like if you. Oh shit!
Oh, what's happened?
No, I just don't want to step on the fucking.
Oh, don't turn off the recording. Because everything we're recording right now is nectar tinted.
Okay, gold.
Here's a question.
Right, anyway. Back. Okay.
Oh, a question.
Wait. I'll do D'Artagnan first. D'Artagnan's a hero. He's the center of attention.
Okay.
And I like being the center of attention because I'm an egomaniac. Possibly,
truth.
But I've got really low self-esteem, so it's a contradiction.
I'm swallowing bogey. Sorry.
Yeah. Guys, working it at his mind. Sisters of Mercy.
Right.
Do you have any information about the Sisters of Mercy at all?
No.
Me neither. I've not been able to stand up. You're gonna have to adjust the levels on this shit because fucking I'm fucking coming across quite.
I am. I'm trying to like. Every time I've been loud, I've tried to maneuver it away from. You know, I'll just leave it in. You know, it adds to the fucking drunken stupidity-ness. Rup. Like I just bumped into the mic and burped at the same time. That's gonna be fucking fried gold right there. That's relevant to the podcast. I like this. It's so hard. It's kind of hard to watch in a way because you feel really bad
Why
for him.
Why would you do that to yourself?
Ow! Nice. Oh yeah, the usages of the word cunt. There's three usages of the word cunt. I can't say usages when I've got this so much alcohol in my system, but yeah, usages of the word cunt, which I did bring up in the Hot Fuzz commentary, but for those of you who didn't listen to that, you're assholes. And for second, there's three usages. Kingay.
For anyone that's interested.
There's three usages of the word cunt in this, and that's essentially because it's not violent in its context. The BBFC, which is the British Board... our film classification are okay with you using the word cunt in a 15 rated film.
Wow.
Which, if you use it in a non-violent or non-sexually aggressive context. It's now back to Drunk Neil, because he's more interesting.
He downed it. No,
only because I feel like I must. I haven't drunk in so long. I feel like I must have missed a few.
No, okay, right.
I don't think I have because we just had a big.
Right.
I like this.
Yeah. But we've all got that.
Oh, he's lost a fucking head. Fucking is. Oh, the fucking amount of saliva in that shot. I wonder which, like, statistically. This is a weird thought. I wonder which shot statistically in the Hollywood of film in the history of Hollywood.
Yeah.
What's the most saliva-filled shot? Like, genuine saliva-filled shot ever? That must be fucking close.
We'll delve into and ignore, but...
There's something for you to ponder.
If you know the most saliva-filled shot in the history... There's the policeman. And,
write to us at expositionists@hotmail.com.
Hey man, fuck that shit. I'm gonna fucking matted all the shit out of this. I actually brought the information up, I never got around to saying it. I'm going to do the numbers on the... No, fuck it. I'm not going to do the numbers on the Mandalorian. I'm going to fucking keep you in suspense. I'm going to fucking... Anyway, the budget was $10 million. Box office was $17 million. Whatever. Music Buzz, right. I can't see it. I got my contact in. Rolf Kent.
Rolf Kent?
Fuck knows, man.
Rolf Kent, he's a composer.
Yeah.
He composed indeed. The intro music to Dexter.
Holy shit! We fucking trivia bombed your ass, and we're kind of pissed.
Yeah.
Let's face it, we're not ourselves.
I can never quite believe that those blanks didn't see them.
Yeah, that's one of those recurring gags in films where people are like, oh, we have to get out of the way of these people. Let's hide in this alley.
And they duck out of frame, but really they should have spotted them.
Yeah.
And I never quite believe that this statue doesn't see them. I guess if you think, like, in terms of line of sight, he's really tall and shit, but... I look at this, like, they're right there! You should have seen them.
Yeah.
But I don't know. You can pick holes in it, but it's still fucking awesome. I don't care. I guess that's the one element of the entire film they could have cut, and I probably wouldn't have missed it. The whole walking. They didn't really do much with it, but it's still cool nonetheless.
I fucking believe it. The King's it.
Number 10. So we're at pub number 10.
We've got a drink because it's...
So if we work backwards...
It's too good, we've got a drink.
We were at pub number 9 when we came to thing. You know what? If you flash back right to the beginning of the commentary when Guy says about the rules that I came up with before.
Yeah.
And I said we had to have a drink in each pub. We're not fucking far off.
Like, I just drank two then.
What pint are you on, do you think, right now?
I've got
You midway through pint 4 or 5.
Pint 4? There's a lot of empty bottles in there. I don't know.
Well, you've got 3 empty bottles and they're like a pint and a bit each, right?
I don't know, say pint 5.
You're on pint 5.
This is basically...
These cans are, believe it or not,
about a pint each. And I'm through 1, 2, 3, 4, 5.
I'm halfway through 6. Oh, no. So, yeah, we're nowhere near. Thank fuck I didn't agree to have a pint in each pub. Fuck, that would have been insane.
Yeah, but we would have killed ourselves.
Like that. Oh, fuck, he just downed a pint. We have to drink.
Oh, we got a drink. Gary's drinking. All right, well, that's all foamy. I'm drinking.
Oh, I feel like I need to fart and shit my ass at the same time.
Shit my
ass. So I can't risk it.
I love that fucking phrase. I use that phrase all the time. I've got to shit my ass. Like, no one else uses that phrase.
I think that's a Jackass thing. I think it's a Bam Margera thing, if you want to be more specific.
It's a very Jackass thing.
I'm about to shit my ass. I think it's a Jackass thing.
I'm going to take my beer, my beer.
Either way.
Relax. I can't relax.
From this point on, the pub crawl has pretty much been abandoned by everyone except for Gary King.
That's because he's hardcore, man. Fucking.
I'm not beating on Gary, or beating him off, or whatever context you want to take that in.
I'm drinking. Fuck it. I'm just gonna drink some more.
But it's the only thing he has left in his life because that's how sad he is, basically. So, I feel like I need to piss again. Oh, someone lost an arm and a head. Mm. And for those of you who... That's really easy to miss, but the guy who lost a head was actually Mark Heap.
Oh, really?
But it's really easy. It's so quick, you can miss it really quickly.
Well, like the Edgar Wright cameo in Hot Fuzz.
That's what... I don't know where the cameo is from, if he's even in it. The fucking guy that's in both Shaun and Hot Fuzz. That they do the cameos in each other's films thing. I don't know if he's in this. Can't remember.
If you call that a roly-poly, does it detract away from its intenseness?
Nah, that's a fucking military roll. He lost a head. So we have a drink. Oh, fuck. All
right.
Okay.
Oh, we're fucking like right at the end.
Oh, we've got no long left. We've got like 15
I've got fucking clue what's going on with
We've got like 15 film. Minutes left of the film. I am... Well, as I said, I'm like nearly 6 points... down. I've almost finished this one. I've got to piss again, but I want to hold it until the end. I opened the fucking floodgates by going to piss that time. It's a bit of a regret. Oh, fucking...
Oh,
he just drank a lot of fucking... That's at least 3 or 4 drinks. Get the fucking... Oh, man, my stomach.
Yeah, what?
At this stage... Right.
You look so fat right now, it's ridiculous.
I don't know if it's like all alcohol or if I literally have a shit the size of King Kong stuck in there. I don't know what's going on, but I need to piss, shit, burp,
fucking fart all at the same time.
Neil's got to blow his ass out, basically.
I really do feel like I'm going to fucking burst.
For it is interesting, we're actually going to film... We're actually going to try filming something else after this.
Yeah, well. I think we mentioned this in a previous podcast.
Boom! Ba-boom! Andy, don't punch me in the face. I'm a sexy redhead, and I was going to suck your cock.
She doesn't lose a body part, so it doesn't count.
Yeah. Rings body part.
Because the last thing I need right now is another drink.
Oh, it was then. Oh, 12.
He doesn't drink, thank fuck. Does he take a gulp? I can't remember if he even takes a gulp.
Oh, that's at the beginning. I'll be honest with you. I was going to try and do the music cues on this. That shit didn't
It's hard to keep up with. There's a lot of music in it. And when you're trying to drink at the same time. Okay, technically he had a sip. So I'm going to finish this can.
Ugh.
Oh, I don't know if I am, actually. Fucking hell. Oh fuck. Alright, now I need to piss. I'm gonna go and take a piss before the climactic scene with Bill Nye.
Pressure is on for Mr. G here. Okay, this is a good fight sequence. It looks good. The lighting's good. That's a good roll. That's fucking shit hot, man. Like fucking oh, look at this. It kind of, like, sucks that these guys are fighting because, you know, they're best friends. And then they're like, oh, you can't fight with a best friend. But that's, like, why ultimately they fucking love each other. Liking that carpet. They're there. I'm floundering! Oh, quick. If I drink more, which is probably a bad idea at this point. No. This is very, very... All I've got... Okay, this is, sums up... There's a really good line coming up here. With the whole... They told me to go to bed line. Which... Just some... It's one of those lines that just sums up a character. And the fact that he's always aiming for the pint. As an addict. Like, you know... It's crazy. Like, that is a fucking superb line. Like, here he is. Like... You know... No help. It's very interesting. Like this is where the cult. This is where the character. Man, you're fucking drunk. Like,
I'm gonna have to do the rest of this stood up because me. I've got a bucket in front of me because my stomach feels bad right now. So I'm gonna do
what the fuck? Are we gonna shit in a bucket in front of me?
No, I like when I was I okay. This is gonna be lovely, but when
bucket,
I was
I say I think shit.
When I was just pissing, yeah. When I was just pissing,
did blood happen? Doctors.
It was
doctors.
Pink. No, when I was pissing.
I love the scene. You have, like, the most important scene in the whole film for this character.
Yeah, well, we're about as most drunk as we're going to be for the most important scene in the film.
Alright, man. I'm fucking sobering up now. I'm just hyperactive. I've got a buzz going.
No, it's really fucking hitting me now. But, like... It's like twice in a row. Like, I've been more drunk than you. That doesn't happen that often. Although, with you, it hits later. Like, as what happened last time. So, I guess it hits me fairly early on. But... Yeah, my stomach's feeling a bit bad, and I don't know if I'm going to throw up or not, so I'm going to stand up, and I'm going to keep a bucket by me, because I don't trust myself to make it through the end without chucking. Lord. Although I actually feel a bit better for standing up, so maybe it's just sitting carpet. In this fucking chair that's doing me in.
Drink responsibly.
So, yeah, here we are with the big climax of the film. With Bill Nye as the voice of the network. And Nick Frost's wonky fucking glasses. So, this sequence, when I saw this in the cinema, like, a lot of the biggest laughs actually from the audience I watched it with actually came from this very scene. My first viewing. How many times? I saw this like 10 times.
Did you see,
had it on Blu-ray. So.
Explain your initial experience of the cinema with this film.
I've sort of gone into it briefly, and a couple of times I've mentioned it. But
this is your...
I saw the entire trilogy back-to-back the day... Well, not even the day of release, although technically. But, like, the day before release, the night before, View Cinemas in the UK...
In Swansea.
had...
They sacked me. Oh, they sacked me so hard.
They did sack Guy, but I've never worked for them, and I just banged my head on my ceiling. And I burped again. They had a screening of all three films back to back. They played Shaun of the Dead, followed by Hot Fuzz, followed by this. This came on at like 1 minute past midnight, so technically I saw it on day of release, which is, I guess, how they get away with it legally. But I watched it all three back to back. They gave us a cornetto for each film, which was really fucking cool. You had a strawberry cornetto for Shaun of the Dead. You have a classic cornetto for Hot Fuzz, and you had a mint cornetto for this, because that's the cornetto that ties into each one. There's the 12, because this is the 12th pub. And
well, let's face it, no one really wants a mint cornetto because they're shit.
I quite like mint cornettos. Really? I like mint chocolate though. Like, I've always gone in for mint chocolate. So
you're a mint chocolate guy.
I'm a mint guy in general. I like mint as a chocolate.
So basically, if I fucking plonked a fucking pack of after 8 mints,
I would take that shit down in 10 minutes, my friend. I don't care if it's a double, a triple, a quadruple, or a single. I am going to take that fucker down. In 10 minutes flat. Right, I'm going to try and sit down because I feel like I should be drinking. I know he's about to rip his head off, so I'm gonna stick to this to the end. I've yet to do one of these commentaries and not stick to the rules to the end, so I feel bad if I give up at this stage, because Guy's never beaten me in terms of sticking to the rules, and I can't yet. And at the moment, I'm doing like the most awkward crouch.
I may have not been paying attention, but I'll be honest with you, I've been drinking a fucking shitload, so fuck it. They may have given it away, but there you go.
Right. Okay, my stomach feels a lot better, actually. I think all those burps helped.
If Bill Nye was a fucking...
I can't tell which of these cans is fucking...
That one's got a little bit on. I should finish that.
Do you reckon if Bill Nye was the fucking voice of, like, Siri or something, you know, like, fucking that would be just
Bill Nye... Morgan Freeman, Stephen Fry, all of them can be the voice of everything in my life, as far as I'm concerned.
Just fabulous voices. Tell you what to do.
But, yeah. As I said, this scene got the most laughs. Where's my headphones? I want to listen to Bill Nye being all sexy in my eardrums.
Oh, Nick Frost is... This is the thing, that whole human... It's a very Christian message, let's face it. Like, fucking... Human beings are flawed. He's my cock. Human beings are flawed. Let us enact out our failures, because we can't learn otherwise. You know, that's a bit fucking Christian, isn't it? Exactly. It is our right to be fuck-ups.
I've never really seen it in any kind of religious context.
Well, no, you can have.
I guess, yeah, there's always a different interpretation.
You can have successive failures. Let's face it, you can have successive failures. I'm banking on that to get me through this life.
All right, I need to drink for
Oh man, dude.
The dude losing his head.
Man, dude.
What Paddy Considine's turned into man dude in this space of time.
It's all about the carpets.
So yeah, essentially from this point on in the cinema I saw it, and it was just wall for wall laughs. Wall for wall? Wall to wall laughs.
We'll get there.
Fuck. I mean, I guess this is... it's probably always been the way with these...
I'm human.
Fucking... I mean, commentaries.
Oh, Nicholas Byrne. I didn't finish off the whole Nicholas Byrne thing.
Oh, fucking... Basil!
Fucking rocket.
Really, check out Nicholas Byrne in a series called Roman's Empire and...
Oh, it's really good. You showed me that. It's good.
Yeah. We'll probably go into that at some point because it's got a big...
I haven't seen it since you showed it to me. I'd have
like
to
Matthew
refresh.
Horne, Chris O'Dowd. You know, the whole thing. It's one of those British comedies that just sort of just disappeared. Also check out Nicholas Byrne's in Absolute Power with Stephen Fry, with Neil Rich reference, and and of course the incredibly amusing Nathan Barley,
which I don't like at all.
How come?
don't think it's funny. I think it's irritating. It just I find it assaulting on my senses. Like, it just every inch of it just irritates the shit out of me. The pacing on it irritates me. The way the comedy is delivered seems forced and irritating. The characters are just like nails on a chalkboard. Nothing about it gelled with me at all. I just can't fucking stand Nathan Barley. I know a lot of people like it, but I just didn't find it funny.
Quite an annoying character. I love
it. It's not just him though. It's everything about it. But then the other thing about it though is I didn't get on with Mighty Boosh, and that's in a similar vein.
Right. Yeah.
I didn't get on with that either. It's a whole thing. I just couldn't get on with it. And I've seen every episode. Guy showed me every episode of it. I just didn't get into it. So I gave it a fair shot, but not my cup of tea. This is quite a daring thing to do with your villain as well. Just have them like, oh, you know what? Just fuck it. You know. At the end. That's how, like, pointless Gary King is as a character and how pointless everything he says is. I love that as an ending. Guy's gone away to take a piss. Like no one's gonna fucking notice. Let's have a running commentary and Guy taking a piss, right? Because I can see him from the lounge. He hasn't bothered closing the door, so I'm just gonna watch him. I can see his ass and he's fucking putting the middle finger up at me as I watch him take a piss, and he's got a big fucking goofy grin on his face as he takes a piss. He's fucking pissing right now and he's laughing away to himself like a madman in a fucking insane asylum. As the final scenes in The World's End play out, as you can see, the three musketeers here have indeed painted the town red with fire, which is a payoff to the foreshadowing that you had at the beginning of the film. As Nathan Barley and his nerdy little friend run away, and that old git that looks, and the old guy that looks kind of like the guy from Hot Fuzz but isn't the guy from Hot Fuzz run away, and I'm literally just commenting on what's on screen. It's a little bit shitty, sorry. So I'm just gonna have a big old drink.
I was fucking busy washing my hands like a fucking normal person.
I thought you were gonna say washing your cock, hey, and that had been
this
weird.
Is what it sounds like when I buckle.
I'm
buckling my belt.
As someone that grew up in Oxford, that joke about the ring road makes me laugh hysterically, and apparently that is kind of what it's based on, because there are a few cities, for those of you who aren't aware, cities and towns in the UK have things called ring roads, which are basically main roads that circle the main city. So you can enter it from any direction. And Oxford has a ring road, which is partially what that joke was based on, is where you get on the ring road and then it becomes very difficult to get back off of it again. Yeah. You don't really know like where you are in relation to the town and where you need to get to. It's quite difficult. Signposting isn't great and everything like that. So, I always relate to that joke because I grew up in Oxford. And, yeah, the joke about the ring road does make me laugh more than it probably would do most.
Well, this is the whole thing.
I'm going to drink to that joke.
You've probably got to address the fact this the whole film...
I love the shot. I love the shot of all the hedgerows lighting up on fire and things like that. I think that's cool. Sorry. Even if it is all CG, I think it's cool.
No, you've got to address the fact that the whole thing, this is ultimately sort of... basically sort of set in the fucking, you know, Milton Keynes in the sort of Midlands and that kind of shit. I went for a piss. I thought I'd miss the fucking conclusion of this film.
Newton Haven is supposed to be, or it's supposed to represent pretty much any town, really, isn't it? I think in England.
Yeah, but it's any town, but it isn't, though. It's like any town around Milton Keynes.
Yeah, it's Oxford area, mid UK. I mean, if you look at
it's a very different.
If you look at the trilogy, Shaun of the Dead is, I mean, it's pretty explicitly northern London, north of the river, London, as you said.
You
in that
Hot
commentary.
Fuzz is definitely Somerset.
Hot Fuzz is definitely Somerset, definitely West Country. They've got all. They've got that farmer accent, which I don't know if I'm doing properly because I've got the headphones on and I can't hear myself talk.
It's not bad.
But, I mean, I should be able to do the West Country thing because there is a heavy, heavy dose of West Country in my own accent just because, like, that's where my mum lives down there. I visited down there a lot. And if you were to go into my ancestry, West Country is basically where I'm from. Bit before I was born, but that is essentially my heritage. So West Country is in my accent
he
a little
an
bit
independent.
There.
He's all for the whole Cornwall independence.
I call myself a plastic Cornish because essentially I'm a fake Cornish person. This is something, I mean, fucking hell, our biggest audience members seem to be in Cardiff, so this will fucking make me a fucking witch hunt, Neil, blah, blah, blah. But fucking, since I've moved to Wales, since I've moved to Swansea, I've always just basically just flat out said I'm from Cornwall, just because fucking the Welsh hate the English, man. I can understand it, because I don't like the English either, and I'm fucking English as shit.
They don't. It's like, having lived in Scotland and England and being...
Well, England is the most hated, in terms of the UK, England's the most hated of the La Bunch.
Everybody
because,
hates England.
Because they're so fucking full of themselves and, we're so English and independent, blah, blah, blah.
It's different. It's like, having lived in Scotland and England and being a native of Wales and living in Wales, it's just slightly different. Like, the Welsh, you know, hate the English, but it's like we just hate the English. It's not really that malicious.
It's just sort of, you're Welsh, so it's a given. You have to hate the English.
But like, fuck it, you know, like, my nan hates the
Welsh.
We
have the only Cornetto reference in the film here.
Great.
There it is, the mint Cornetto.
It's like, you know, my nan, who's from Gloucester, because my whole mum's side family from Gloucester, they hate the Welsh because there was a point way back when... on a Sunday, say, you couldn't drink in Wales, you know, all the pubs are closed on a Sunday. So they fucking bum over the borders of Gloucester and they fucking cause a riot every Sunday. Yeah. You know?
And the thing is about, for those of you who don't know the geography of the UK, Gloucester is so close to Wales that it might as well be Wales.
But it is English.
It's like right on the border and it's just the English side of the border. I like this little bit about the coin.
The coin, yeah, that's kind of odd,
isn't it? It's a cool little thing.
But like, having lived in Scotland, and
for those of you who didn't pick up on it, the two actors here are Rafe Spall and the chick, I can't remember her name, but she's the president in Battlestar Galactica. She's a good actress. Yeah. She's cool. She's also the president's wife in Independence Day.
But
I just spilt fucking cider on my fucking self.
A true man, Neil.
I am a true man. And as a true man, by the time we hit the credits, I'm going to drink whatever's left at this point, just to...
so we can finish it off.
It's the same, but I'm...
What were you saying about Gloucester and Wales?
No, Gloucester... having lived in Scotland and being sort of, you know, Welsh and English, the Scottish hate the English, but they hate it with... You know, I was in a bar... You know, I've been, like, in fucking... like, in a bar... above Waverley Station, you know, watching the end of like the Six Nations of the World Cup, waiting for pick a friend. You know, me and my dad were in there.
This is the only Sisters of Mercy track in the album, I do believe. Is this Sisters of Mercy? I think so.
He's put me on the spot, people.
On the basis that Guy's like our music guy, essentially. I figured he might know this off the top of his head. I feel like I might know it more because I've probably listened to the soundtrack more than he has in this instance.
Guy has a CD collection. Although, in all fairness, his eyes aren't working very well. This corrosion...
Those are the twins. They're in each of the films. Just so you know. They play twin zombies in Shaun of the Dead.
Oh, yeah. Those are the guys that fucking...
are the twin, like, people that work in Skinner's Safeway shop. As well, and they are in this. So if you thought the twins were in it, there they were. You also had that big guy who plays Lurch, the zombie, and Shaun of the Dead. He's also in an episode of Black Books about... fucking some Baltic country. Uzbekistan, is it? Where Fran learns that she's got ancestry and she has a Volvo. He plays the son of the family in that. So he appears in a lot of Nera Park... related comedies, actually. Oh, so I guess she sort of carries them over. Oh shit! I just. Oh fuck! Let's podcast first. I am going to raise a glass to my microphone and clink. Oh, there we go. That's what you want.
Wow. I'm Gary King. I'm going to fuck you up.
And there we have the credits.
Oh.
A song which every single person I see this film with say this is a really strange song to end with. But if you look at the trilogy as a whole, this is actually a very sensible choice because
Harris Mines,
and this is something that Edgar Wright said, and it's very much true. This film of the three has the happiest ending of the three. And when you really look at it, that's actually true. At the end of Shaun of the Dead, Shaun has lost his best friend. His family are dead. It's really hard to talk about this one.
Honestly, God, I love Paul Heaton as a songwriter, man.
Singing this all the way through. But yeah, at the end of Shaun of the Dead, everyone's fucking dead. Like, all of Sean's best friend and his family are dead. It's not really a happy ending. It kind of feels like a happy ending, but it isn't. At the end of Hot Fuzz, you have the really good cop. If you look at this in a real life, real world situation... having Nicholas Angel as a cop would be a really good thing because he'd basically eradicate the world of crime. But at the end of that film, he's basically just gonna become this fascist dictator cop where he's just gonna, he's like, oh yeah, let's go and beat up on some fucking hippies. That's what we're all about now. So it's really not that happy an ending that town is now ruled by this fascist dictator guy. The end of this, humanity has realized that the most important thing about humanity is sort of just working with nature and being one with the world that we were given, which I guess does tie into your Christianity thing.
About Christianity.
Yeah.
I'm drunk.
So it really is the happiest ending. Everyone gets past, they get past all their fucking modern world bullshit. Realize it doesn't matter and just fuck it, let's just survive on with whatever we're given. And this has got the happiest ending, even though at first glance it feels like everyone loses at the end of this because the world essentially ends. But you know what, it has kind of got the happiest ending, which is why that song sort of ties
in. The world
in,
ends, but they all learn a lesson.
We're happy nowadays. That's why it kind of fits better. In terms of I did have a point and I have forgotten what it was.
I'll be honest. I'm going to be honest with you, Neil. I haven't watched the film in about an hour, so I'm not quite sure what's happened.
I haven't watched the film in about an hour.
For the duration of this.
Yeah.
I got a little bit
tipsy. I have been keeping up with where we are. I mean, I know, as I've said, I think I said this earlier in the podcast, I've seen this film...
quite a lot.
I've actually seen this film more than I've seen Hot Fuzz, which is kind of ridiculous when you bear in mind how many times.
I'm going to be honest with you, I still think Hot Fuzz is my favourite.
That's something we need to do, actually.
Ratings!
We didn't do shit ratings for the end of Hot Fuzz, so...
yours was 9, wasn't it?
We've already done... yeah, my shit ratings for the entire trilogy are, and I will still stick with this for now, is that Shaun of the Dead is 7% shit. Hot Fuzz is 9% shit, and this is... again, 7% shit. Although, as I said at the beginning, I do in many ways prefer this film to the others. So, what is Guy's shit ratings?
For the trilogy?
Yeah, go for the trilogy.
Okay, I'm going to go... I'll go 987.
987.
9 for Walt's End, 8 for Shaun of the Dead, 7 for Hot Fuzz.
So they...
Go through that again. 9 for Bald's End, 8 for Shaun of the Dead, and 7 for...
okay, no, that does make sense. I misheard that.
I'm going to be honest with you, I love all these films.
Each one is less than 1 out of 10. No, each one is less than... is a better than a 9 out of 10.
Yeah, Neil's pissed.
Fuck off, so are you.
I'm not pissed, I'm merry.
I'm merry,
I can go fight off the Witch King. I dropped a fucking Lord of the Rings bomb on you. Right there.
You did. Well done. This is...
get a medal for that.
As I've said before, I think this is my favourite of the few because...
oh, shit, we got stuff to film, though.
Like... I think there is more to actually, in terms of reading into the film and everything like that. I think there's more to this than there are the others, and it's essentially just for the replay value. I think this has got more replay value than the other two. I've seen Hot Fuzz a lot of the times, but I do think I have got everything I can out of Hot Fuzz at this stage.
He says after watching 80 or maybe 10,000 times.
Yeah. I mean, Shaun of the Dead, as I said in the Shaun of the Dead Hot Fuzz. In the Shaun of the Dead commentary, I think I've seen that probably about 100 times. Hot Fuzz, I think I've seen it, probably still in single figures. I think I've seen that 8 or 9 times. This, at this stage, I've probably seen about 20 times. And
Neon loves this. Is fucking...
This just isn't getting old. I'm always finding new shit as the film ends and you go back to the menu. So, there we are for that. I just keep getting more and more out of it, and on that basis it keeps creeping up. It may make its way to like 6% shit eventually and completely knock out Shaun of the Dead, but at the moment it still sticks with 7 and being equal in terms of rating, but I think in terms of if I was given one film to pick from this trilogy, I would go for this one before I would go for Shaun of the Dead by a nose, marginally.
If you can, like, sit down and watch one.
Yeah. Just because I think if I wasn't drunk. I mean, the thing about me and films is I love sitting down and fucking really focusing in on a film.
Yeah.
I'm not... I'm all for a film you can just sit down and watch without really thinking about it. There's a huge benefit to that. But if it's a film that forces you to think about it and forces you to analyse what's going on and forces you to pay attention, that's a bonus for me. And no matter what mood I'm in, I can do that. You're not the same. You can't just sit down and really, really get invested in a film. You have to be in a mood for that.
Depends on the film. And Guy kills the conversation.
No, not really. Just want you to explain, because on the basis of what I understand about your film taste, that's not how I understand it. So explain that.
Don't throw questions at my face, man. I'm a little bit pissed.
Okay, right. Okay. While
look at him running.
Look at him. That's the menu. That won't make any sense to anyone.
It will. The menu screen's delightful.
Only if people are watching exactly the same copy, and for those of you that are interested, we're watching the UK version of the Blu-ray that came out in this country late last year, but Blu-rays tend to be multi-region, so it probably doesn't make a difference anyway.
It's a bubble.
If you're watching the DVD, you probably finished the film like 10 minutes ago, because we know there are differences in formats. Right, I need to read my mum's review of this film so I can read it to you, because I think everyone wants to know what my mum said out about it.
For the record, my mum...
I'm going to do that, and Guy's going to have to ad-lib for a couple of minutes.
Oh, shit. I like the fact Neil's fucking gaming chain, and he, like, sort of did a bit of a rock and roll, and he twatted his mic across the screen. But there you go. Look at him. Look at him. He's so funny. Right. For anyone that is interested, we sort of half-filmed, half-assed... an experiment.
Why don't you start doing the silly stuff instead?
You just fell on the floor!
Keep going, everything's fine.
Holy shit, man!
I missed the sofa! What do you think?
You could not have timed that better. Neil went to put his armrest, his right arm, on the settee. There was nothing there. Roll, boom, boom. What the fuck, man? Anyway. There are plans, half-assed plans, for basically what happened was, way back when, Mr. Neil, do you know him? He's the drunk one.
Oh yeah, this is kind of related to the podcast as well. I didn't realise that was actually connected, but yeah, keep going.
Are you really? No, really, I'm sorry. No, Mr. Neil himself, I'm going to take his headphones off, he entered a competition somewhat a time ago. to design a... Neil's just knocked fucking empty cans all over the place. To empty a... Empty enter. I'm surprised how much I concentrate more when there's music in my right ear. yeah. Enter a competition to design a beer mat for the World's End. It was a competition I'm sure some of you possibly heard about. But it was like...
It was on the Universal official website.
There you go. And, you know, Neil designed this... he's off for a piss. And he designed this quite spectacular... I apologize for that noise. He designed this kind of cool... It was a, like... Designed a beer mat for the World's End. And Neil knocked out this really good design. It was actually really cool. It was like a fried gold thing, and it had like a silhouette of Simon Pegg from all three films.
It wasn't silhouettes.
It wasn't silhouettes, as Mr. Drunkard would say. Anyway, regardless of the thing, you know... wow, you're really back. Fucking drunk. So what happened was, you know, Neil was like, you know, he saw the winning entry and thought, do you know what? Mine was better. So Neil goes...
That's not what happened at all. I entered it on, like, the first 2 days.
No, you did. But then you saw the winning throw and you thought... Well, you
know, not really. Okay, what actually happened? From my point of view, because Guy doesn't actually know my point of view of this story, because I don't think I've actually told him properly, but...
Wow. So leave me in the shitter to tell a story about your point of view. Get nice one, then.
Not necessarily. I just really needed to piss, because I knew I couldn't make it to the end of the podcast without pissing. So... I saw everyone else's contributions and I figured, you know what, I can do fucking better than every single one of these. Right? Not to be big-headed, but I'm better than those people. So, I went on to fucking Photoshop and I created a piece of art that was, like Guy said, it was based on the fried gold thing. It was supposed to be a beer mat. It was supposed to look like a beer mat. And I took each character that Simon Pegg plays and created... like a cartoon representation of each character using only the colours red, black, and white. So you had Sean, you had Nicholas Angel, and you had Gary King in the middle holding a pint. And using only those colours, essentially, although I did cheat a little bit and actually had to use a bit of green in the thing, because the only colours I used were red, white, and black in most of it, although I did have to use green for the cornettos. But yeah, that'll make sense in a minute. I had each of the characters fried gold written underneath, which is essentially an in-joke for anyone that knew behind-the-scenes information about Spaced and knew the line from Shaun of the Dead. And then I had cornettos, the different cornettos of each film, underneath, sort of underneath the characters that are relevant.
Respective
Shaun. Yeah. Respective Shaun or respecting Peg. Respective Peg.
Respective Peg, yeah.
And submitted that. And it did rather well in the competition. It actually came second. I don't know who came first. They didn't really release who came first, second, or third, but I know I came second. And they struggled getting into contact with me initially, but they've got hold of my email address or something. I think I wrote to them asking, like, who came first, second, third? Because I was genuinely actually quite curious to know who came first, second, and third. Because
fucking ego riding that shit out.
I thought, like, yeah, mine's better than some of these people, so I want to know if one of these useless people beat me. But no, they sent me an email, like, oh, we've been trying to get hold of you. You actually came second. And as a prize, they actually sent me this World's End dartboard, which I have up in my hallway in my flat.
It may feature in some kind of video that we may or may not be.
Yeah, we're filming like a little short sort of thing to go with it, and probably be up on YouTube. Look for The Expositionist on YouTube, and you'll probably find it along with a bunch of adverts that we never really fucking used. But yeah, search for it on there and you may well find it in the near future. It might well be up there by the time this podcast gets released, so Christ, yeah, go to YouTube and have a look. Guy's going to edit it together and we'll see if it works. If it does work, it will be posted. But anyway, that's enough of random fucking bullshit. We're both pretty drunk, so we need to do the Selly stuff.
I'm a little bit pissed. And we're doing the Selly stuff? I thought we did a fucking
We have not really done it. So,
right, earlier on today,
if you want...
Earlier on today, Neil and myself participated.
Yeah, but if we can do it
live and kicking, sort of Saturday morning. Hello.
That if yeah, but if that like
that's for the episodes where we haven't done the Sully stuff live with the audience.
I love the way Neil's grabbing his mic, man. He fucking look. Oh, it's so good.
No. But if we can do this live right now, okay, I think we should right. do it live. And part of the... It was hilarious when I tried to do this last time.
Is yep. It was a very good place to email us.
That's really not the website at all. It's expositionists@hotmail.com.
Shit,
you
man.
Can find us on Facebook by searching for The Expositionists. You can follow us on Twitter by searching for @expositionists. You can find us on iTunes by searching for XPod or commentaries. Give us a review if you have the time. We'd be really super appreciative if you could do that. Thank you very much if you have already. If you haven't, please do it. If not,
I think the only person to give us a good review may be you.
Today. People don't know that's me. Shut the fuck up.
I'm going for a piss.
Okay. You can find all of our content
www.badgerman.net/ And it looks fucking... /expositionist.
Guy says he designed the website. Although technically...
You designed the website.
The expositionist part of the website is my design. The guy then had to awkwardly make fit into Google Sites because it didn't really fit properly.
There were many broken keyboards and panes. I'm not going to put the fucking beer down. Fuck it.
Are you going to sign off before you go? Because we're like literally at the place where we need to sign off on this podcast.
To sign off, I'm gone.
So we're both pretty pissed by this stage. Thank you for listening to the podcast. Find us on all the things I just said. If you play along with the drinking game, let us know how drunk you got. Send us some videos, send us some pictures. Fuck someone, I don't give a shit. I just thrust it at the mic and that won't mean
sex
fucking
and
anything.
Drink and rock and fun films. It's a good thing.
So until next week, I am Neil.
And I am Guy.
Thank you very much for listening. Goodbye.
Where'd that come from?
There we are, we're done.
That was good. I really hope we never lose that recording. I'm quite pissed. I have to go wee-wees.
Right, I'm recording. Fucking...
Okay, so Neil's got a review in hand.
Yeah, I fucking forgot to put this in the main bulk of the recording, so I'm actually going to fucking read it now.
This is a postscript. It's like a PSS.
It is, like a bonus feature for the podcast. Okay, so I'm going to sit down. And I'm going to, with rather blurry eyes, try and read this shit. Okay, so this, as promised earlier, is Neil's mum's review of The World's End, right? The segment you've all been waiting for. Okay, so from this point on, everything I say will be from what my mum wrote basically to me in an email. I thought The World's End was fantastic, and ultimately the most enjoyable installment of the ice cream films. Like any good book or story... Oh no, sorry, I misread that. Like any good book, the story is filled with mystery and intrigue. The questions over what has happened to the townsfolk and the reasoning of the villains' actions kept me engaged to the end, which I didn't see coming. Simon Pegg's character, I forget his name, but it has something to do with kings, is a deeply flawed individual who manages to be both the most irritating leading man I can think of, while at the same time being lovable and entertaining. It's always more interesting to have a main character who is fundamentally flawed and in many ways despicable, as it challenges you as a viewer. Sorry, I keep messing this up, by the way. I'm not that sober.
He's drunk.
Not that there was anything wrong with... Sorry, back to my mum's review. Not that there was anything wrong with the policeman or Sean. I didn't care enough to look deeper into their characters. With this man, however, meaning Gary King, it was half of the fun to try and figure him out and to consider the idea that he is ultimately more of a villain than a hero. The World's End is funny... as well as interesting, and one of my favourite British films since Life of Brian. I can't wait to rewatch it and pick up on all the bits I missed the first time. Just wish there wasn't so many masky bits in it. Love and hugs, Mum. Kiss, kiss. That's Neil's mum's review. Enjoy that. I did. Goodbye.